This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com. The only place to be in your pop culture world.
Come on, come on. We call it the place to be.
The place to be, yes.
The place to be.
Then I shall be.
Place to Be Nation, Scott Criscola and Justin Rosero. This is the Place to Be podcast.
It is contagious. It is the place to be. And we are live each and every Monday.
To do worse than Josh Richard. The days can't be like the nights in the summer in the city. In the summer, in the city. Cool town, meeting in the city. Dressed so fine and looking so pretty. Cool cat, looking for a kitty. Gonna look in every corner of the city. Till I'm wheezing like a bus stop. Running up the stairs, gonna meet you on the rooftop. But at night, it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Place to Be Nation, welcome to another great episode of the one and only Place to Be podcast. I am co-host Justin Rosero, coming to you live here on this Tuesday evening inside the PTBN studios, and it is a very big episode for multiple reasons, and we're going to get into those reasons as I bring in my PSC, Mr. Scott Criscola. Scott, how are you?
Good evening, JR. Good evening, Place to Be Nation. Welcome to episode 499. Indeed. Brett Favre, Mark Gastineau, of the longest-running episodic motherfucking gold standard. And it is not JR 2028, which you had predicted what year we'd be when we get to this.
Well, we're not quite there yet. It could get delayed. You don't know what could happen.
This hurricane
could just destroy the whole country. And
yeah, exactly.
That'll do it.
So, happy Rosh Hashanah to our fine Jewish friends.
Of course.
And listeners. How's it going, JR? Everything well? Tonight? Comfortable weather this evening?
No, it was uncomfortable.
Really?
It was disgusting.
I mean, it's humid here, but there's a breeze.
Yeah, try running for an hour and battling Andy. You'll fucking feel the humidity.
That's true, yeah.
It was like I jumped in the pool, like right down to my underwear. Like everything was just fucking drenched when I got home.
God.
It was disgusting.
Oh,
yeah, that's it, though. I think next week's probably going to be the finale. We'll see.
Mm.
Is it starting to get dark at 7, which is always depressing.
Yeah, it is.
But it is what it is. So that's about it. It's been a while. How are you?
Yes. Very well.
Ate a lot of chili since the last time we talked.
Yeah, and lost again, so fuck it. As Mean Gene would say, a year from tonight.
I think this
tonight.
Thing is rigged.
Oh, it's definitely rigged. There's no doubt it's rigged. I said it to him. I said it to his face. I said, you always conveniently put yourself first at the table. You're always the first one everybody tastes, and then God only knows what the fuck you say. So I told him that. I said,
you think he slips it's like chili into Armento's pockets?
I think so.
Swing the votes?
It's kind of like Jesse lifting up fucking Dino Bravo's bar. Who's his Jesse?
Think he lifts Dino up Armento's spoon?
He finished third, that fucking jerk. Yeah. Fuck him. I don't feel bad for him at all. But anyway,
he's
it was a good time.
Third and he lives the longest, too, so you're good.
That is true. If I finish below him.
That's it.
Anyway, it was a nice day. All my money for charity, as always. So it was very good. You, my friend, though, sent me a picture. Now, we haven't really talked about this because every time you and I are on and we have a WrestleMania New Orleans alum on that you hung out with, you always seem to talk about the Duke's barbecue and other people's barbecue. And which one was it that made the jambalaya?
Jambalaya Jake.
Jambalaya Jake. However, JR, was it Labor Day weekend? You sent me the fine picture of those slathered ribs that you made. I have to say, very impressed, my friend. I know you made the pulled pork earlier in the year, but those ribs looked damn good. I have to say, well done.
They were delicious. Yes, we made them for my parents' birthdays. It was Labor Day, and they came really good. But I do study at the altar of Nick Duke when it comes to barbecuing, so I get all my recipes and tips from him.
Good.
He is triaging throughout the day. I'm sending him pictures. Am I doing this right? Where am I at?
Triaging.
So he's helped me out along the way. I'm sending him videos. But no, they came really good. I was proud of myself. They fell right off the bone. I could barely lift them off the grill without them breaking apart.
That's perfect.
So I'll make you some soon.
Oh,
win the rib contest.
Speaking of Armento,
and speaking
of ribs, talk about this.
Yeah.
Might as well bring it up now. Well, can't see his. You do know that Thanksgiving weekend, when I come in, of course, for the annual DAT festivities, that Saturday evening, your beloved Friars of Providence do take on his Gales of Iona.
Mm-hmm.
He alluded to boneheads.
The ghouls of Iona.
I shuddered the thought.
Yes.
The ghouls of Iona. We don't have a tip-off yet, though. I told them I couldn't really plan anything because we don't. I went to your website today. I went to PC Friars, or what is it? Friars? Is it just Friars? I think it's just Friars.com.
It's on the Saturday?
And it's the Saturday, it'll but there's no tip-off yet.
I think it'll be a night. I feel like they rarely do...
4 o'clock. You think it's a 7?
That day. I feel like if it's on the Saturday, it's probably a 7.
Okay. So, I said if that's the case, he won't come alone. He'll bring another motley bunch of fucking ghouls. So anyway, we'll talk more about that as we get closer, but he did allude that to me the other day. So, anyway.
Some rough-looking fellas at the dunk that night.
Hopefully this gentleman joins us.
He'll be there. Rotella will be there. That is a rough go for those poor fucking girls.
I love it, though, because they'll all eat wings. So. Yeah. speaking of a motley bunch, why don't we bring in the motleyest of motley as the third member of our team this evening?
Yeah, and that is the man. It's fitting, because I've said this all along, that our next episode, Scott, is episode 500. And
yes.
we'll talk about that in a minute, but it's not going to be a vault. It's going to be the trivia and everything else. So this is kind of our official vault 500 in a way. Like, it's, you know, our first vault was, episode 3? So we've been doing this all along, and this is really kind of the final vault before the big milestone. And I think it's fitting that our guest tonight, who often joins us for pay-per-views vaults these days, is one of the OG fans, found us really early on, going to contact us with it really early on. If you listen to that, you know, first, 25, 30 episodes, you'll hear his name pop up in the feedback. So I thought it was pretty cool that it all timed out to not only be him coming on, but also being a pay-per-view, which is our bread and butter. So, like, it's cool that it's not, like, just an MSG house show. It's something that we've kind of done before. It's a big pay-per-view. We're redoing it, and we have John D'Amato on, who has been with us forever. So, they're all timed out. And we didn't plan this. It was all timed out this way for this to be $4.99. Right. So, Johnny, how are you tonight?
Beautiful. Thank you, guys. I'm gonna try to hold it down, hold back the tears. It's gonna be a little emotional. You guys have... a lot of insults, but a lot of praise and love over the years. And it's a pleasure to get to know you guys through the podcast and to get to know you guys in person. And we all friends for life. And I know you only have me on for the fart and the dick jokes and for the Lanny Poffle auto fellatio jokes. But it's gonna be emotional tonight. We're gonna mix it up a little, and I'm honored. And also, it's great that because we just celebrated the 30th anniversary of this show.
That's right.
And coincidentally, yep. Scott dropped a 30-pound deuce after that chili contest. So,
yes, I did.
It's a lot of 30s coming.
I dropped the Dino Bravo right after the show, right after that day. So there we go. Barbell and all. Yes, John, always a pleasure. And of course, tonight for episode 499, since Mr. D'Amato is in the building, that is pay-per-view, we bring you the inaugural of arguably, I mean, for years it was the second probably most popular pay-per-view brand in history. It's probably third now. I'm sure the Royal Rumble's probably surpassed it, but this was always my favorite pay-per-view brand, and that, of course, is tonight the inaugural SummerSlam, or as Vince used to say it, SummerSlam, as he says here as well. So, for years, JR and Johnny, we needed a show filler to fill the gap between WrestleMania. I mean, last year, you remember, between WrestleMania 3 and Survivor Series 87, it seemed like a fucking eternity. particularly, you know, with Andre off camera for all those months and mm-hmm. Hogan wrestling, like, various different guys. We had our moments. It was fun at times, but it definitely got a bit of a slog. So, now we have a big show to, and hopefully we never have a WrestleFest ever again because that didn't work in so many
no.
ways.
it's good too, because it in our timeline it helps because it just replaces the MSG show. It's not like this was somewhere else, and then we still have to do like an August MSG because I feel like it's already been like I was talking to Peter Winston today because it's been a while since he's been on. He does the Saturday Night's Main Events with us, and it's crazy how much is crammed between the Saturday Night's Main Events during this stretch. Like, when,
I know.
Like, the last one was, what, April or May? When was the last Saturday Night's Main Event?
The last Saturday Night's Main Event was...
April. It was April 30th. Loading my...
Yeah, it was April. Well, they always take the summer off. Like, for right. instance, 86.
But this time, there's not one to the end of October. Did they do a September one in 87? I feel like they did.
Let's see.
No, I guess not. Well,
no,
you know what? It was October 3rd,
October 3rd.
So anyway, I was just looking at the schedule like, wow, we haven't done a Saturday Night's Main Event forever. And my point was that there's a lot jammed into the summer. A lot of MSGs, they didn't skip one. You get SummerSlam, you get WrestleFest. So there's just a lot going on since we've been on national TV. And yeah, it's fitting. So obviously it's a big night. John, do you have anything on what led to this decision to do this show? Was it just success of pay-per-view with Survivor Series and they decided a summer show to bridge the gap? Made a lot of sense.
Yeah, they weren't still 100% on board with, pay-per-view was still in its infancy. So they were still relying on the house shows. But also, they introduced Survivor Series last year. Just to fill in that long gap, they figured they'll experiment with this. And they had it on a Monday night with their usual MSG, which is their MSG night, pretty much. Most of the shows you guys review is on a Monday. So that they didn't really settle into that Sunday pay-per-view tradition that we're all so accustomed to. So they still weren't sure as far as getting away from the houses, let's try it and introduce another. And you could tell, I'm sure we're going to discuss it. The card itself, it's pretty much geared towards a one match, and most of the other matches are to avoid spoiling stuff for the future house shows. So I'm sure we're gonna discuss that ad nauseum, I'm sure. But this is another Monday night pay per view, which is weird for those of the younger listeners that are so accustomed to the Sunday night slot.
And it stays that way till 1994 SummerSlam. Not till 1995 when they make all their pay per views on Sundays. So it becomes a Monday night. And for a while there was it usually timed out to be a lot of times it seemed like the Monday when you're going back to school. Like the weekend before Labor Day or whatever. Because I remember multiple times in high school, SummerSlam would be on, or at least. I guess it would have just been my freshman year. When I started freshman year of high school, SummerSlam 94 was on the Monday. It was the night before I went back to school. So I remember that kind of being a thing, too, around that time.
Yeah, the last week of August is a heavy vacation week. So they figured that people are drained out from being at the beach all weekend on a Sunday night. So maybe on a Monday,
Well, and also Mondays were usually the MSG show night anyway. So Vince probably back in those, still kind of keeping that thinking. It was probably just easier to keep it on a Monday.
This might have already been booked. They might have already had MSG booked and then decided to make it the paper. Like, we don't know how early in advance they decided to do the show. So I guess it could have been that they had the Monday night, the usual Monday booked anyway and decided to beef it up.
That's true as well.
And of course, part of it was just to challenge, keep putting the pressure on Crockett, obviously. To do that. So, and they just
speaking of Crockett,
WrestleMania 3 was obviously huge. Survivor Series launched and everything else. So.
Right, exactly. Speaking of Crockett, because obviously everyone was at the Garden, there was no other WWF shows going on this evening. We'll just give you a quick what Crockett was doing on this evening. It was a house show at the Municipal Auditorium in Greenville, South Carolina, which of course would be. A well-known Nitro haunt and a couple of big moments there in the following decade. But here was the card. Kendall Windham versus Kevin Sullivan did not take place as advertised. Oh, shucks. But Kevin Sullivan, who subbed for Larry Zbysko, defeated the Italian Stallion. Al Perez defeated Chris Champion, who was subbing for Ron Simmons. The NWA TV champion, Mark Rotundo, and Rick Steiner, of course, the Varsity Club, defeated Brad Armstrong and Ron Simmons, who was subbing for the Road Warriors. Not there. Sting, Ricky Morton, Bobby Fulton, and Tommy Rogers defeated Ivan Koloff, the Russian Assassin, Luke Williams, and Rip Morgan. We'll let you know some of those guys are down the line. And the main event had the U.S. Tag Team Champions, of course, the Midnight Express, taking on the NWA Tag Team Champions, Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard, to a double DQ. So we had a heel main event on this night. Two of the greatest tag teams of the decade, and probably one of those teams will be in our tournament, JR, or in our count. I should say not our tournament, our project this year. Mm-hmm. One of them. Two heel teams wrestling in the main event. So Crockett had a show on that night. But obviously WWF did not. Everybody was here at the Garden. Your announcers. And at first we thought back in the day in the pre-house show days, JR and John, we never really thought about this, but we thought, oh, they threw this guy in just for the hell of it. But in reality, He had gotten a decent amount of practice in this building throughout the year. Gorilla Monsoon, mm-hmm. of course, our man Gorilla, who hasn't done a garden show since, what did he do, January, I believe?
Yeah, I think
right?
so. I don't think he's
he did the January. Yeah. I think he did the he did not do the Rumble. I don't think he did. Did he? No, he did do the Rumble. He did the January house show. He did the main event, and then I don't think he's done anything.
Well, Mania
since other than well, I was about to say every. Yeah. I don't think he's done a show for us since besides right. WrestleMania 4. So he is back, except for the one match that for WrestleFest, but that was a voiceover for primetime. Mm-hmm. His commentator, guys, a guy that we are very comfortable with in terms of getting to know, and that is Superstar Billy Graham, who, of course, has been doing the house shows here at the Garden since, what, April, I think. Yeah. And clearly, this is his best play-by-play guy that he's had. True. We've had to deal with
I will
Roger
say,
Kent
though,
and...
and I will say, and I think we'll see it because he does some more going forward, when I used to watch the show, like, he aggravated the fuck out of me. Mm-hmm. But, like, watching him more and, like, getting more used to his style and his cadence, it actually made this not as bad for me. Like, I think I've just gotten used to him at this point, whereas in the past it was just kind of like, it seemed like he was throw, like you said, like he was thrown in there just because Jesse was reffing and he was a fill-in and he kind of was, ugh. And now, like, that I know, like, he did a bunch of stuff, like, throughout that year and we've heard him. I think I've just kind of gotten used to his cadence and his style. And the one thing I'll give him is this, is that he's enthusiastic and into the storylines. Like, he really is pretty good at putting over the storylines, pushing the guys that need to be pushed. Like, he's pretty in tune with the product, which I don't think you would glean from, like, just watching the show if like we used to, but kind of seeing him evolve made me, I don't want to say appreciate him more, like I would prefer other people, Bobby or Jesse or whoever, but it gave me a little bit more, like, all right, he's not that bad, because of his excitement and because of how into the show he is and into the characters he is, and he does a nice job putting everyone over. So I'll give him that. Obviously, he still has his tics that we'll talk about. But right. overall, I thought I came to not mind him as much based on us watching. How about you, John? Has that been the case, or do you still feel the same?
Unfortunately, the biggest drawback is he hurts Gorilla so much because Gorilla is so great when he plays off a heel, when he plays off Brain or Jesse. So Superstar's cheerleading really brings Gorilla down too with him.
Right.
So that's a big drawback for me because I love more than anything when Gorilla goes at it with either Jesse or Bobby and. There's really not much, so he kind of brings him down.
Yeah, it's a lot of buddy-buddy, and yeah, they're pals versus the
Yeah, you need a good heel in there.
All right, Scott, anything else for the intro, or are we ready to go?
No, I mean, I'll just say my thing quick about Superstar Billy Graham. I agree with you that I think we're more accustomed to him after the one match, though, they just drove me nuts, and actually Gorilla did, too. It wasn't just Superstar, but when we get there, we'll get there. But no, why don't we hop into the Red Hot Garden sellout and dive in?
I'm sorry, guys. Just one more thing about the visual opener where they showed. Of course, today we have to mention it. They showed the the shots in New York City with the towers. Mm-hmm. And of course, with that classic SummerSlam music introduced for the first time. Very, very memorable opener.
No, definitely. Yeah. And that'll also hang around for, I want to say, I don't know how long they use that. 90.
It eventually turns, well, it eventually becomes the Rumble theme.
Oh, right. And then the other SummerSlam. So this was the one that becomes the Rumble. That's right. This wasn't the dun, 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 dun,
dun. I think that starts in,
I think
they use this theme next year. And I think 90 they use the one we know.
Okay.
I think this one goes to the Rumble in 90 because it's so damn good.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I like this one better.
Yeah. Yeah. Your buy rate, 4.5. And I bought this on pay-per-view, so, but I'm pretty sure they were still doing some moderately decent close circuit, I'm assuming,
yeah,
at this point. Yeah.
All right, so here we go. And they do the open, and Billy Graham's all fired up for Hulk Hogan's big return tonight as well. So that's another big treat for the local fans. And we saw that hyped, obviously, last month where Fink read down the whole card. And that brings us to an opener. You know, John, you hinted earlier that we were getting a lot of matches that weren't really building or continuing feuds because they were trying to keep things apart for the houses. But this is one we're actually getting here. This is a feud that has been raging on for a bit with Each of these teams kind of costing each other. We've seen the Fabulous Rougeau brothers cost the British Bulldogs a title match, and those are the two teams hooking up tonight to open the show. And that is the Fabulous Rougeaus, who have turned heel, like we've been chronicling, and they're playing this kind of, you know, smarmy, all-American boy stuff up, saying they're moving to the United States. And not only have they been feuding on TV, but there's also some real heat between Dynamite Kid and Jacques Rougeau, and as a result, both teams. And as the legend goes, there's a skirmish backstage. Jacques sucker-punched Dynamite in the face, fucking up his teeth. Dynamite wanted revenge, and if it was evident, if it wasn't for Agent stepping in, it could have gotten real ugly. And this match took place after that incident as well. So there you go. Many people thought Dynamite might take revenge or take liberties, and he doesn't do it. So I guess kudos to him, because, you know, how much of a loose cannon he is. But anyway, so a little backstage heat added on to the feud here that was raging on screen as well and in the houses. So it's been simmering all summer, boils over here. Rougeau's have cost the Bulldogs the titles in this very building, as we mentioned, and they're booed quite rigorously. Gorilla questions those mini flags as the Bulldogs then come out with Matilda to a pop. The Rougeaus try their fake sportsmanship acts, but the Bulldogs ignore it and get right to work with Davey battering Jacques around the ring. Ray tags in and finds a seam and punches away, but Davey comes right back and unloads, as does Dynamite. Dynamite works the arm as Jacques tries to rally a USA chant, which made me laugh from the apron. The Bulldogs are in full control, swatting away any attempts to take over and battering the rivals. They keep going to the arm as Gorilla wonders why the brotherly instinct hasn't kicked in yet for the Rougeaus. And it finally does, because they get to Davey's knee and start to work that over, quick tagging, picking apart the joint and the hamstrings. Graham says Dynamite has to get involved here some way, anyway, to make a save and use that five count to take a shot. Davey's knee's really taking a beating here. Davey gets a monkey flip, rolls to the corner, makes the big tag. Dynamite comes in hot, runs through Jacques with a snap suplex and a headbutt. The crowd's feeling it as Dynamite keeps pouring it on, but it can't get the three count. Ray then comes in. He gets chucked out, and the Rougeaus regroup. Back in the ring, Davey and Dynamite smack around Ray as Graham says they have to turn away thousands on the street tonight. Just picture thousands of people hanging out around Madison Square Garden trying to get in. Davey gets a power slam for two, but Jacques makes a save. Dynamite gets drilled from behind, and now Jacques starts to lay in the wood, zeroing in on the midsection, going for good pins. And Rougeau's really lay in the stiff kicks here until Jacques goes to an abdominal stretch. Jacques turns that into a seated chin lock, and the Rougeau's double team to keep Dynamite locked in. Dynamite eventually powers out and drives right to the corner, but he can't make the tag as Jacques comes in and kicks him down. The control segment rolls on from there. We get the usual Rougeau theatrics, as Graham says not one ref cannot control all four men. He stole Gorilla's line. I wonder if Gorilla was pissed. Davey finally gets a tag, but whiffs on a dropkick. He comes back in, hoists Jacques up into power slam, but he stumbles back and crotches him on the top ropes. Gorilla says that's inadvertent, even though we know he does it every match, but Gorilla plays it off like he doesn't. Things break down into a brawl. Davey slams Dynamite onto Jacques, but the ref is tied up with Ray, and then the bell rings for a draw. Tough way to open the show with that finish after a pretty hot tag match. Feud seems to be continuing, though, so they keep both men strong, but I think they should have had the Rougeaus cheat for a win here. I thought that would have made much more sense with the way this feud has gone. Instead of going for the draw, you have the Rougeaus pop them with something and steal one. Fine opener. That's about it. Not much more. I went 2.5. So, Scott, your thoughts on the match, your thoughts on what the finish could have been, and do you believe there's any credence to maybe they did the draw just to kind of appease the two teams that were not getting along backstage?
Point one, I gave it 2 stars. It was fine. I thought it was a good dance. I thought the work was back and forth was good. I thought Superstar again. I definitely was paying attention. I knew going into the main event later. I knew I was going to get annoyed because I always get annoyed with the two of them during that match. But Superstar I thought was fine. I thought Gorilla, you know, for once, Superstar's working with a play-by-play guy who kind of knows what's going on. I mean, think about who he's dealt with: Roger Kent, fucking Mooney. And did Dick Graham do one? I think Dick Graham did one too. He's dealt with some real fucking dregs, and now he's working with the cream of the crop. And I think he's actually settled and is actually not bad. So I think Gorilla's kind of holding his hand, you know, figuratively, and getting him through, you know, because an MSG house show is one thing, but a pay per view where you know a boatload is watching is a little different. So I thought that was pretty good. And the match I thought was fine. Both teams are great. What was your second, before I answer the one about the draw, what was the second one?
No, so the match, the finish, and then if you thought the
finish. Oh, the finish.
Or if you thought the finish, yeah, had anything to do with the backstage animosity.
Yeah, I would have probably gone with, I would have gone with the Rougeau's winning. Again, we've talked about the Bulldogs. They're the hotter team. Oh, they're not the hotter team. The Rougeau's are clearly and the MSG results have shown that. I know they try to keep it in a vacuum, but still, the Rougeau's on syndicated television are looking better. Now, in non-kayfabe, I don't think Vince gives a shit, to be honest. I think they just did it to do it. I don't think they did it to appease anybody. Fuck them. You know, they're the employees. You know what I mean? So Dynamite's pissed. Tough shit. Yeah. Get over it. You know what I mean? Like, you know, Vince is the boss. Vince,
well, I know it was more, yeah, just trying to keep the peace. And, you know, if they picked the Rougeau's to win, would Dynamite shoot on? You know, like, so I didn't know if they just were, all right, just go out there and wrestle for 20. And,
You know what it is, JR, and I think we'll talk more about this. I'm curious your thoughts too, Johnny. When we get towards the end of the year, because we do see the on pay-per-view anyway, we do see the Bulldogs one more time. If at this point they were starting to realize that they were kind of, you know, yesterday's news to a certain extent, and whether they really didn't care and just were kind of going with the motions, or maybe there's credence to it. I don't think there is because, again, Vince is the boss. You know what? It's a draw. You don't like it, too fucking bad. There's the door. So I'll ask you the question. I'll ask you the same things JR asked me. Your thoughts on the match? What'd you think of the finish? And was the finish booked in a non-kayfabe thinking?
I think it was the other way around, that the Bulldogs were supposed to go over, especially being that this is the opening match, and usually you want to give the crowd the jolt. So I think it was changed to appease the Rougeau's. But I look for some evidence of unprofessionalism or, you know, some hatred or something. But they kept it professional between the ropes. Obviously, in the locker room was another story. But I didn't see any evidence of all the drama that was going on in the locker room.
No, they definitely kept it pretty professional for sure. Yeah. So you think the Bulldogs should have won here? Because I feel like the Rougeau's are just kind of getting going with this whole gimmick thing. Like, and the Bulldogs, like Scott mentioned, are kind of yesterday's news. They've had their summer tag run with Demolition, and now, yeah, I don't know. I feel like the Bulldogs.
Yeah, well,
be phased
from the booking purposes, definitely. But I think in this instance, where they're for the first match, is usually they want to get the crowd a crowd pleaser, so to give the faces the win.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the only reason behind that. But yeah, you guys didn't. You guys didn't kill Graham too much, but right away he sets the tone of his announcing style with about 6,000 brothers. And and another thing I discovered, not only brothers, but Gorilla Monsoon. He says his whole name about 100 times, including one time he says, Davy Boy's leg is taking too much punishment. Gorilla Monsoon, brother. he snuck them both in.
Like none of us knew who he was.
Oh God! Yeah, I guess we all get immune to it after a while. And also, I still can't believe that Matilda was still hanging on all this. But according to Pritchard, it was because of that when they had those when they had that get well Matilda, they were swamped with like a million friggin' cards. So whatever that whole angle was popular, and so they dragged poor Matilda out there. But that poor dog was exhausted. One time they showed she was propped up on the ring, and they showed a shot of on the ring. She wasn't even looking at the action. She was looking away. She was like looking at the camera saying, you know, Peter, help me. I'm hungry. Alpo, motherfuckers, please.
And I don't think Matilda came out, right?
No, she did, definitely. No, definitely.
Oh, did she? Okay, because I thought I heard.
Yeah.
I thought so, but I thought I heard Gorilla say, oh, they didn't bring Matilda out. Maybe he was mistaken. He didn't see her. Okay, I thought.
Yeah, one time there was a good shot of her, and like I said, she was looking away from the ring. And that
right,
poor
okay.
Dog, and her tongue was dragging on the floor. She looked exhausted. She looked like a double A after his fifth bowl of chili. And had about as much energy.
Well, who knows what friggin' Dynamite had done to torture her
exactly.
You know, backstage or whatever before that.
Hung her by her
tongue. Oh, yeah. Yeah. But this is the most important thing, that they really fired up the crowd. The crowd was still behind the Bulldogs. They were still hot for the Bulldogs, and the crowd reacted to everything. All the heel tactics by the Rougeau's, and on that spot where Davy Boy crotch jocked on the top rope, the crowd gave a nice pop. So I go 3 stars on this. This is textbook tag. Of course, you don't like the finish, but everything else was great for an opener.
I can't decide yet if it's just lazy, like, Bulldog repeating the spot every match, or if it's, like, supposed to be part of his repertoire and he's doing it on purpose. Because the commentators always tell it as an it's a error, you know, an error or a mistake. And it's like, if it is, then the fact that he does it every match gets annoying. Because, like, you should do it every match if it's a mistake. Like, but if they sold it as part of his repertoire, then I would buy into it more.
And also, I noticed that, too. I was surprised. It was actually Gorilla who said that there should be two refs. Gorilla kind of gave a shot at his son. He made that comment saying that there should be two refs in these matches.
I think he tried to just one-up Billy, who stole it from him.
Right.
Yeah, so I was thinking, too.
Right.
That's funny.
All right, so we go back to Superstars, where we see Outlaw Ron Bass attacking Brutus Beefcake, sliced him open with a spur, knocking him out of action tonight, screwing him out of his big Intercontinental title rematch from WrestleMania. Gorilla says, we don't know who'll face Honky Tonk, but there will be the next number one contender in line. We'll get that shot. And, of course, we don't see the attack, or we don't see the remnants of the attack. It's got the X over it to not let us see the blood. Did you guys see that live?
I did. I remember that Superstars very well, actually.
Yeah, but they all, from what I remember, they always had the X.
Yeah,
that's right. They did X it out. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it was always X. Yep. I don't know if he was actually bleeding.
Well, they sold it that way. Right. He may not have actually bled, yeah.
Or if they just did that to kind of sell the... I mean, it didn't surprise me either way, but...
Do you want
to
talk about the Beefcake, or do you want to wait till that match? Maybe we'll wait till that match. I want to talk about what happened with him and why he...
Yeah. Okay. No, we can wait till we get to that match.
Okay. Definitely, yeah. I got a lot on that. So.
Okay. All right, let's go to our next match, then, and that is a big one for us here, Scott, because one of our favorites, Ken Patera, taking on Bad News Brown, and... I think it's fitting for $4.99 that we're talking about Kenny Boy, because he was a whipping boy the first time through these shows, made fun of his hairy legs, especially on this show. I think in particular is where we really got into the
hairless
legs. Yes, I'm sorry, hairless legs.
He wished there was some hair up.
But like a few others that we've come across, mea culpa on Ken. I've enjoyed him as a face in this run. I think he's been enjoyable. With his energy, has been infectious. I think he works hard out there, and he's over. So. I've come around on Ken as watching him through this. Now, he's not out there tearing the fucking house down, but, you know, he's better than I thought, and I'll give him credit for that. We'll see if that continues here as he takes on the Bad News Man, as Billy Graham calls him very many times. Ben is Brown. Interesting match. Brown keeps trying to find his footing. Patera's hanging on. Brown attacks at the bell and slugs away and then slams Ken down as Graham runs down Patera's entire resume for us. Ken hits a clothesline, finally gets his jacket off and stomps away. Patera's all fired up. He comes up empty on an elbow drop. Brown chokes and stomps at Ken and batters him around until Ken lands a punch and takes down Bad News for the pin attempt. Graham says Bad News Man isn't hurt enough for a pin attempt yet. Ken hits a clothesline. Brown sells it awkwardly. Ken just runs through a bunch of pin attempts. Graham is still is all over these attempts, basically saying they're a waste of time. Ken goes to a bear hug and then keeps laying in strikes before trying for the full Nelson, but Brown immediately gets to the ropes. Ken gets caught with his head down, but Brown doesn't capitalize. Brown dodges a charge. Ken hits shoulder first into the post, and Brown hits the ghetto blaster for the win and a pop. The MSG fans liked that one. Awkward and sloppy, but I liked it in a way because it felt like a legit fight. I've mentioned this when we were doing our SummerSlam rewatch, too, with a group from Placement Nation staff, that I feel like a struggle more than like... Like, it didn't feel sloppy to me. It was sloppy, but it didn't feel, like, botchy, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Like, it felt like a fight. Like, they were really going at it. But Brown's selling is so awkward overall. Like, he's just so stiff the way he falls and flops around. And I thought Patera had his usual fire, but they didn't really click. I went a star, which is probably 3 stars higher than the last time we talked about this match, Scott. But again, a lot of it has to do with just Patera in general. I thought he really kind of carried this. And he also got a ton of offense. Brown gets, like, no offense until the end. So I thought that was interesting that Ken eats it up and then Brown just gets the pin. So 1 star, John, and I thought it was interesting overall. It's kind of the way it was booked. And did you get the same kind of, like, slugfest feel out of it, like that they were really kind of struggling in a fight?
Yeah, obviously it you can't rate it more than a star. So, but it served a purpose. It was the ghetto blaster is really a great finishing move, and it really got over. Like you said, the pop from the crowd for a heel was, but it was sloppy. There was one time where Patera gave him like an awkward whip into the rope, and they kind of just like went around, like did like a dance around in a circle and stuff. And the superstar was jerking off on Patera. Look at his legs and thighs, girl.
Oh god, he loved it.
Yeah. He was creaming all over, which was a sight. But
explains the creamy legs.
Yeah.
Here what do you guys, Billy Jack, Jager over
there. What do you guys think? I mean, I know we shit on Patera a lot, but don't you think his the angle, like, and the whole face turn kind of just got stunted from the beginning? Because like his very first angle, he pretty much got revenge on Heenan right there. Like, Heenan tried to attack him with the belt, and he got his revenge right off the bat. And it kind of even made, like, Heenan a sympathetic figure. So, and his run was supposed to be, like, going after Heenan's guys, and he never really got that run. He got hurt, so his whole face run, he was kind of stunted there.
It's his hair, and I'm serious. I really believe that. I really believe his hair played part of it. Because he looks kind of goofy. Like he had the, I don't think they ever brought him back for anything serious. So I don't think there was a point. Like, I think the point was to stunt the push, like, let him get the revenge on Heenan and then become a jobber to the stars, pretty much.
And also, as a babyface, it's like, wow, you didn't come visit me. You know, it sounds like whiny. It's like, oh, who's going to feel sorry for that? It's like, oh, you completely abandoned me. You didn't come visit. You didn't come bring me a cake with a knife in it.
No, he did. He looked like a bitch. So, yeah, I don't think he was ever meant to be more than that.
Yeah, they didn't do him any favors.
Maybe I have turned to the dark side. I actually gave this 2 stars. I thought this was a lot of fun.
Yeah, this is the same as the opener.
I thought this was a lot of fun as the – yeah, for a different reason, though. You could quantify grades. I thought it was a fun little brawl. I thought that it served the purposes for both guys. I've kind of grown on Kenny. I mean, look, JR, we went from trashing him, and we gave him we have an award named after him now. So we really have turned the corner. But I thought it was a lot of fun. I thought it was a fun little brawl, and it made Bad News look tough. And the crowd was into it. I thought it was fine. I agree with you that Kenny probably wasn't – you're right. He was brought in to do the Bobby storyline and then to put over talent. That's pretty much what it comes down to. Having said that, let's see, the problem is we wouldn't have gotten the tag match later. I would have loved another Bad News Brett match here. Mm-hmm. But obviously, Brett was busy later in the show.
Actually, I'm fine with that after WrestleFest. That was good.
I wasn't sure. I would like to have seen. I mean, you had to put Bad News on the show. He's one of the bigger heels in the company. By the way, your match time. I don't know where they got this time for the opener, but the official time for the opener was 11:19. So I don't know where the draw came from with the random.
I noticed that. That was like it definitely was short. Although I thought it was a little bit longer than that. Was it only 11? Is that what Graham has it as?
I'm looking at our old Vintage Vault refresh, which you can follow along with us at placebnation.com. And we have that, and I think that's
Graham
where we get ours.
Graham has it 1903, so we might have.
Oh, jeez.
That might be a typo.
All right, well, what is Graham? I have, we had 635 for this match.
Yeah, 633, he has.
Okay, so where the fuck did we get 1119 from?
I wonder if
that's
I got a cage match maybe or something, but maybe they had it wrong. I knew it didn't seem that short. I knew it was short of 20, but I knew there's no way it was only 12 minutes. Okay. They weren't going to pull that.
Okay, so 1903. All right, so that makes sense. Yeah, it makes sense. All right, 635 for this one. Yeah, I mean, Kenny was another one that – this was a big roster fleshing show.
Mm-hmm. Well, not as big as our next pay-per-view. That's the one that's like the real chips passing in the night.
Yes.
In November. That's one like half the crew leaves and half comes in and that's it.
Exactly.
That's the swan song.
I agree with you.
Show.
Yeah. But there's definitely a few. There's a few here. I don't think Kenny's at Survivor Series.
Yeah, he is. He's
at Survivor Series. Okay, so he's got one show left. But it's evident that Vince is looking to get rid of some of the older guys and really try to, you know, young up the roster and lower the median age of the average guy.
We're trying
guy.
To do placemation.com. It's not working.
So. Anyway, 6:35 your runtime, and Bad News Brown gets the win, and rightfully so. But yeah, I mean, Kenny has served his purpose. The hair is just abysmal, and I don't know if it was that weird mechanical like who has an arm thing that like cybernetic? Fuck that stupid arm thing he had on for like 5 months.
It seemed pretty advanced for a 88. That thing.
I know it did, right? Yeah. It's like fucking I don't know. It was like. Tinker Toys or some shit. I don't know. It was weird. Anyway.
Although Forrest Bad News had those braces on his legs. What was that? 19?
No, so that was the 60s.
Something. Yeah, so okay. Yeah, so maybe it's okay.
59. Even in the late 50s.
They should have done that. They should have had a run out and
So there you go. Bad News Brown gets one.
They should have Patera run to the ring and it falls off his arm as he's running. Kenny, you can move your arm, brother. Look at those sexy arms.
Kenny Patera, you can move your arm. Kenny Patera, what do you think, Gorilla Monsoon? Kenny Patera can move his arm.
Kenny Patera's arms are so big, he broke right through that brace, Gorilla Monsoon, brother.
Anyway, all right, so there you go. The win for Bad News Brown.
All right, Mean Gene in the back with the mega powers are all jacked up for tonight. The strongest force in the universe, Savage has never felt so much electricity. And they are together, and they have a secret weapon tonight, Scott and John, and that is Miss Elizabeth. So there you go. And that does bring us to our next match, and that is Junkyard Dog taking on Ravishing Rick Rude. Of course, the real feud going on here was behind the scenes, or not behind the scenes, but behind this match was Rick Rude taking on Jake the Snake Roberts. They have been warring. We'll get to more on that as we move forward in the coming months, and we'll see actually a touch of it here tonight, too. And I'm trying to check quick if the JYD, because he's not at Survivor Series, but I feel like he might have him on one more MSG, maybe. Let's see. If not, this might be it for him for us. Nope, he's in September. He's there. Okay, so we'll talk about him on our next show. All right, so here we go. Random match here. The first time Rick Rude's been in MSG since December, so we haven't seen him here in a while. Rude does his shtick and strips down, and JYD's on life support here, really, as he staggers out to a pop, relevance waning day by day. Graham's loving the JYD, though, in his chain, but Rude attacks at the bell and lays in some forearms. JYD comes back with a big backdrop and then pelts some headbutts and knocks Rick to the floor. Rude comes back and takes over some hard forearms and elbows and club off the top rope. The crowd tries to rally JYD as Rude keeps laying in shots, going to a chin lock. JYD battles up and shoots Rude to the corner, eats a boot on a charge. Rude gets two and goes back to the chin lock, but JYD powers up and bows up and stalks Rude. Heenan gets on the apron and JYD gets all distracted, leading to Rude hitting a knee and getting a Russian leg sweep. Rude goes to the top and pulls down his tights to reveal a second pair of tights under them with Cheryl Roberts' face on them. That's Jake Roberts' wife. He hits a fist off the top and gyrates, bringing out Jake to smack him around and chucks him from the ring, and that woke the crowd up. Rude wins by DQ, but the match itself was a snoozer, and Rude still hasn't had a very good or great match that I've seen here since we've been watching. And this one, although I will be hard-pressed to pin on him, I think this had more to do with the JYD. So I want a star and a half on this, Scott, mainly for the end. I like the finish with the tights and Jake coming out and getting a shot in, but Dog really just has nothing left in the tank.
I concur. Your match time, 3:55. I'm going to change my grade. I originally gave this 2 stars, and now that I'm thinking about it, I'm like, what the fuck am I smoking? So I gave it a star. JYD is just a mess. His days are numbered. And Rude is definitely getting there. I know we've talked a lot, JR, about kind of Rude, particularly in-ring, having his struggles and trying to get comfortable. And I think he's finally getting there. That top rope thing, that weird fist drop, just looks so awkward. I don't know why he tried to do it, why he used to do it. The only good thing he did it on this show is because he pulled down his tights and he had the Jake's wife's on them, which was cool. But I've always thought that fist drop off the top rope looked so awkward. I don't know why he bothered to do it, but he had a lot to deal with tonight. JYD was just fucking cooked at this point, literally. He needed to go. Love JYD. The 3 years, or the I guess you could say what? Well, I guess 3.5 years if you count all of 85. So, I mean, 3.5 years we've had him. He's been great. He's been a great babyface. For a good time, he was probably the number 2 babyface in the company behind Hogan. But, obviously the company at this point is passing him by. And he's yesterday's news, just like, kind of the Bulldogs are and some other guys. So I wasn't expecting much in this match, and we didn't get much in this match, John. But the Jake run-in saved us from this match having been any longer. At least they realized they weren't going to do more than 4 minutes. So it's probably smart to leave it that length. But, JYD just doesn't have it anymore. It's time for that ship to definitely sail off to the sunset. However, and I'll get more into this when Jake comes out later, I'm kind of glad now that I think about it, we didn't have a Jake Rude match here. But I'll get more into that when Jake comes out. But what are your thoughts, John?
Well, Rude hit the one of his classic promos of all time with the inner city sweat hogs. Yes. That's one of my favorites. Even though JYD was cooked, he showed he could still have it when he fired up a few headbutts. The crowd probably gave him his last New York pop there.
That's right. He belongs on the Indies. Just go there and or a territory where that you can do like three or four. Like he's really getting aged out here, completely. Mm.
Oh,
you
know? Yeah.
Especially be on big shows like this.
But for old time's sake, the crowd gave him a little love on the way out, and also of course there was one time Rude knocked JYD down and you know, looks like he hit him in the head or the face. And Gorilla and Graham specifically said that he must have got hit in the nose, because if he hit him in the head, he wouldn't have went down.
Of course.
He's got such a hard head.
A hard head.
And then you get the classic Rude chin lock, which you can't be blamed for this match. But all his matches have that that little rest period for Rude. But Jake's pop was bananas. And that's what this match is all about, just to further that angle.
I think part of that pop had to do probably with him coming out to end this match. That was just going nowhere. The Rude thing's interesting. Like we still haven't seen that Rude match. I mean, I'm waiting for it. What was the closest we've seen? Maybe that the Steamboat won at Rumble.
That's close. Yeah.
Let's see what we got for. So yeah, he fought Jerry Allen last July. Nothing. Orndorff, we gave 2.5. Scott, that was October 87. Orndorff, mm-hmm. Rude again. I went 2.5. You went 2. Steamboat in December, we went 2.5. You went 3 at the Rumble. I went 2.5. 4, we know. 2 for Coco on Science Man Event. 2.5 for... for me, he stopped out at 2.5. And for a guy that's as heralded as he is, I'm waiting for more. So we'll see. We'll see. All right. Gene is with the Honky Tonk Man and Jimmy Hart. They're yucking it up. Gene says Word is a very formidable challenger with an extraordinary physical capabilities will be getting the shot tonight. Honky has no interest in even finding out who it is, doesn't care, says he loves surprises, and we'll wait and see who his challenger is here to replace Brutus Beefcake. And that leads us to our next match, and that is the Powers of Pain, once again taking on the Bolsheviks. Third time around for these teams, second straight in MSG, and of course they fought at WrestleFest as well. Slick is out there with the Bolsheviks, and Graham saying he looks clean tonight, brother. Which he did, he looked nice. Slick shits on the fans, Nikolai starts to sing the anthem until the Powers of Pain music cuts him off, and the POP are joined by the new manager, the Baron, who of course is the legendary Baron von Raschke. He's out there with his cape covering most of his face. And just kind of stands around. They charge the ring. We get a brawl at the bell. The Powers of Pain clean house on both Russians, driving them to the floor. Warlord holds Nikolai, and Barbarian chops him in the throat, and he bails right back out. Boris actually gets a touch of offense in on Barbarian, but it's fleeting as Barb cobbers him. Boris just falls down, and Barb tries to grab him, and Graham says Boris's head looks like a basketball. Warlord comes in and keeps pounding away until Slick runs some interference. It allows the Russians to go to the throat and double team a little bit. Graham calls Warlord a big giant sequoia as he withstands all the double teaming and a chin lock. Eventually beats off both Russians as they drop to their heads. Barbarian gets a tag and cleans house with strikes and clotheslines. Warlord comes in and we get a double flying tackle to set up the finish of a Warlord power slam and a Barbarian flying headbutt. Slower than the last two matches and way too much Bolshevik offense in here. Should have been more of an ass kicking like July. Baron added nothing. I don't even get why they had him out there. And the Powers of Pain look great. Gorilla is very horny for them to face Demolition. Extremely horny. I want to start here, and I think it's been diminishing returns. The best match was the July one, and we've kind of dipped since at the WrestleFest in here. And that July one was so hot that they should have just done the exact same thing here. Just whatever. Just have them murder the Bolsheviks. Who cares? We don't need Bolshevik offense. Set up the Powers of Pain as legit monsters. Let them go over on pay-per-view with just a dominant performance. That's what I would have done here, John.
Yeah, I can't add much more because I have the same sentiments exactly. Why would you make the matches even longer? I guess for the pay-per-view, but the matches should have been even shorter. The shorter the better. Bolsheviks should have got no offense, but I'll give them credit though. The finish was great. That kick to Nikolai, knocking him out, and then the double team and the Baron. My God, didn't they learn their lesson with the face managers? Just such a disaster from Albano at the end as a face manager to Humperdinck to the Baron. They just don't work. This is a rough show for managers. We'll see another shit manager come up later, but this is a rough time compared to a couple of years ago when we had Blassie was still around and Heenan and the Mouth who's still there, but they went down as far as managers are concerned. Simply.
I agree with you, JR. I wish this was more of a squash. I gave this, I did give it 2 stars, but I would have liked, I know I'm getting very, I'm agreeing with John. I think I'm getting way too nostalgic, but, I was pumped by the Powers of Pain. I thought they looked really good.
Pete Criscolo. I hope it doesn't fall asleep on us. Do I hear him snoring?
Hey man. It was really good in 94. I love you, Pete.
I can't wait to. We got to get Pete back for the December MSG. His yearly trudge into the worst show of the year.
Yes. Incidentally, the last time Baron von Raschke was anywhere, he was down in Crockett. He was at a house show at the Omni on June 7th, 1987. He and Todd Champion lost to Rick Steiner and Sting. I bet he was probably dicking around AWA, probably, most likely, because that was kind of his home base, and then came here. I thought the match was fine. I think the Powers of Pain are definitely a team that Vince really wanted to jump on. However, the crowd has been kind of fucking around with these teams a little bit, and we'll talk about it later in the show when you mention Demolition and the gigantic boners everybody's getting to watch the Powers of Pain and Demolition go, because they're the two biggest, baddest teams right now. But as for who you'd root for, I don't know. The crowd's kind of making things difficult for the bookers as to who's who. And we'll get more into that at our next pay-per-view outing. But I am curious, JR, if we kind of see the same thing at the September and October house shows, if we get that same kind of energy change pertaining to Demolition and Powers of Pain. But I enjoyed the match. I thought it was fine. Powers of Pain are awesome. Seeing the Baron, who I'm trying to think. I'll have to ask Kelly, JR, when we have him back on. Unless you can remember, Johnny. I don't know if you could, but I'm trying to remember if the Baron was in WWF like in 80 or 79. 80. Like he wasn't on All-Star, but I'm trying to think if he had ever been in the WWF. Maybe in the mid-70s, probably? Or was he mostly AWA the whole time? You think? Yeah, you think he ever came to Vince?
Maybe for a show here or there, but I don't recall.
I don't think so either.
AWA solely, yeah.
Yeah, AWA, Crockett, maybe a couple of world-class hits, probably. But
so Baron actually,
anyway.
His first appearance was on August 23rd in Providence at a Superstars taping. He appears on TV. It's taped for September 24th, though. And then September 13th, he is on September 18th TV, and then here, and I think that's it. So he only lasted this show. It looks like just this show and then one TV taping. Actually, no, I lied. So he's at the October 6th TV taping as well. That airs 11/6. So basically three tapings and a pay-per-view is where he shows up, and then he's gone. So really, really brief run. I'm wondering why. I guess we'll see. Do you remember, like, did he talk at all on TV for them? Is that why they brought him in to talk for him? Because he doesn't talk here at all.
I do remember a couple of promos. I do remember. I'm pretty sure that
Vieta, we think.
Like on Superstars or Challenge, a promo or two. I definitely remember him talking through, like, the hood. What do you think, John? Do you remember any? I definitely remember one or two.
Yeah, nothing memorable, but
But I do remember him doing it though.
But they had. I'm just wondering if that's why they brought him in, was to talk for them.
Yeah, probably. I would think so.
Yeah,
I would think so. Yeah, I can't think of any other reason.
Nothing more than a footnote. All right, we go to a very special segment up next, guys. And Brother Love ambles out for a very special edition of the Brother Love Show. So have we seen him yet? By the way, Brother Love, is he at MSG at all? I forget. I don't think so, right?
No, I don't think so.
All right, well, nope. I guess we should talk about him then. Of course, portrayed by Bruce Pritchard, again, wrestling in or bringing his career working for Paul Bosch out of Houston, Texas. At age 10, started selling posters. Worked his way up from there, and after Bosch sold his Houston territory to WWF, Pritchard moved there, and just as a color commentator as we heard before, events in Houston area. If you remember that awful one where it was him, Mike McGurk, and Duke of Dorchester. And then, so he did some TV shows there, did some house shows, and then it created the Brother Love character. It debuted in June of 88 to red-faced, smarmy, boisterous Preacher. Of course, really meant to be playing off of all of the Preachers around the Jimmy Swagger and those guys that were all just everywhere in the 80s and early 90s. So, of course, he was a heel, has a big white suit, the red tie, was spreading the word of love, and was very, very disingenuous towards faces, and, of course, loved all the heels, especially like DiBiase and Heenan were kind of his boys. And so he was brought out to basically a new age Piper's Pits and Snake Pit and all those shows we had, which I guess we've kind of lacked for a while, right, since the Pits went away. I mean, I feel like we haven't really had one. Was there anything in between those? Piper's Pit pretty much ended in early 87. I think the Snake Pit ended around the same time.
Yeah.
Has this been podium interviews since?
No.
Yeah, right. Jesse really didn't do the body shop anymore.
They never aired him, but to replace Piper was supposed to be a Missy Hyatt, Missy's Manor.
That's
but,
right.
Missy's Manor, yeah.
They were so bad that they never aired.
Hmm.
Yeah, she wouldn't put out. Most likely.
All right, well, anyway,
they're
that's
on YouTube. I've seen them. They're not too horrendous, I don't think.
Okay.
If anyone wants to check them out.
It was tough. I mean, filling Piper and Jesse in those shoes. Like, that's a tough shoes to fill. So, anyway, so Brother Love will be around as this character for about almost 3 years. So we'll see more of him, of course. He said he was promised a very special guest, and then he shits on that guest and then brings him out eventually. And that's Hacksaw Jim Duggan. He stomps to the ring. Duggan calls Brother Love a phony. Brother Love says Hacksaw has no love in his heart. And then he puts over Dino Bravo as a man of love that loves his country. Duggan calls bullshit on that, says his patriotism should never be questioned. Brother Love says he's a man with a weapon with no love. And Duggan says, get out of my face. Duggan says it's WWF, not Sunday school, and there should be policing around here, and he'll do that policing. Brother Love says he doesn't have a badge, and Duggan says he doesn't need one. He's going to shove his board up Brother Love's ass if he doesn't leave on the count of five. Brother Love bolts, and Duggan stomps around. A decent bit here. They kept it quick, which was good. It didn't drag on. Brother Love's a pretty good troll, and Duggan's pretty over. So I thought this was fine as a time killer to get Brother Love over with the pay-per-view and the local audience, and it was fine just to use Duggan here. So thoughts on this, and also thoughts on, you know, they're originally rumors that, and I don't listen to Pritchard's show, so I'm not sure if he's talked about this there or not, but I know rumors originally that Ric Flair was maybe going to be hired before this show. There were talks of him being in the main event, and then I thought I had seen rumors at one point that he was maybe going to be here with Brother Love, and Duggan was just a standby replacement, and because that didn't happen. Have either of you guys, I guess, what do you think of the segment? Have either of you heard any of the Flair rumors or anything else that was supposed to go here? Like I said, I don't listen to the show. It may not have been from there, but I thought I saw that posted somewhere at one point.
Definitely. That was it. And they pretty much had Duggan on standby. He wasn't on the card. So Vince said, yeah, just to put Hacksaw in there.
So it was supposed to be Flair?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
According to Flair's book.
He said he was going to be in the main event.
He said it was going to be him and Savage in the main event.
Right.
I don't want to say Flair's lying, but I mean, maybe Flair's mistaken.
They could have talked about different things. I mean, they could have talked about that, and then maybe they had a backup where if he couldn't wrestle or couldn't get out of his whatever, that he'd be on the Brother Love. So there could have been. This is a good chance both guys are right or both guys are wrong. Who knows? I mean, they could just be remembering options that were discussed.
Right. Well, I mean, you're figuring, and we can get more into this maybe in the main event if you want, but you're figuring that our main event tonight was the main event all along. That's obvious. I mean, the build was there and everything.
But my thought is, if suddenly they think they can get Flair, maybe they were willing to change it. And maybe that was the talk originally. And then as it got closer, and they're like, well, we wouldn't have time to build it up. And if we just have him come out, maybe we stick him here. Like, you know what I mean? Like, them talking about different options may have been the evolution of the plan, right? So if they're talking to Flair, like, in May, they might have been thinking, oh, let's bring him into Wrestle, the main event, and we'll sell this huge show and fuck Crockett. And then maybe they were talking about it closer to August and said, oh, we can just have him show up here at Brother Love.
That's right.
Like I said, both guys could be right. Both guys could be wrong. John, what did you think of the actual segment, though?
Not too much. Until they started shooting angles on the Brother Love, I was definitely not a fan of his. But then, as we'll see in the future, it definitely became the hot segment with the with a few of the most memorable angles of all time. But I don't like But it popped the crowd with Duggan's little shtick. And like I said, they kept it short, and they're gearing up for that hot Duggan Bravo feud. So. But overall, not a fan of Brother Love. It wasn't a rousing debut.
Were you surprised Duggan wasn't on the card?
No, I mean, technically he was. I mean, they threw him out there. Whether he's in a match or whether he's here.
Well, if he wasn't, if he was standby, like, are you surprised that they had him in that role? Like, that they wouldn't give him a showcase match?
Yeah, no, not really. His feud was kind of at this time was with Andre, and obviously Andre's on bigger and better things, so he's kind of in between, and they're kind of gearing him up for Bravo. So it was I was cool with what they did here.
What do you think, Scott, of this segment?
Well, because I've tolerated Duggan's matches a little bit doesn't mean he's my favorite guy by any stretch. His promos still suck, but it served its purpose. If it was winging it and kind of promote or premiere Brother Love as this, new crappy interview segment or heel interview segment. But it was fine. It was a good fill. I feel like it wasn't totally necessary, but it serves its purpose. For, keep Duggan as a decent face character, particularly, that the Garden crowd has seen some decent Duggan matches. Mm-hmm. I know that the point of the pay-per-view is not, we've talked about not, having house show local stuff combined with, but look, Garden crowds are Garden crowds. It's the same people
right. Most
of the time. So you might as well appease them. And Duggan's matches, particularly against Andre, in our stretch of house shows has been really good. So you might as well, if he's hot, keep him on. So I got no problem with it from a perspective of keeping the crowd hot because they've been into Duggan. If he was an audible because it was no flair, then that's fine. But I think it was fine. Good for Duggan. That was a good choice as to wing it as an audible. You got to put him on the show. He's one of the more popular baby faces. Brother Love is a character. Again, interview segments are better for heels, and this was a good one.
Mm-hmm.
There's only one Roddy Piper. There's only one Pitt. We all know that, and that'll never change. So if this is as close as we're going to get, then I think we're good.
Yeah, I think he does as good of a job as you can.
Yeah,
with what he was stepping into. So, all right, our next match is a big one, and that is our Intercontinental title match, and that is the Honky Tonk Man defending against a mystery opponent after Brutus Beefcake was taken out of contention thanks to Ron Bass, like we mentioned earlier. And that replacement is the Ultimate Warrior, who has, of course, worked his way up the ladder throughout the year. Honky and Jimmy come out dancing, smiling and confident. Honky grabs the mic. He calls out the challenger. And then suddenly that music hits. The crowd goes bananas. And then this was awful. Gorilla and Graham play so dumb over whose music it is. Like, if you're not going to say who it is, just, like, stay quiet. Or say, oh, my God. It sounds so dumb for them to
Gorilla
be like,
says, oh, that music is familiar.
We know that music from somewhere. Horrible. Yeah, brother. It sounded so dumb. It's like, just stay quiet. Like, just don't say anything. Like, why do you even have to, mention anything? Just shut up. So Warrior comes out, the crowd's going crazy. Warrior just murders Honky, finishes him off with ease to win the title, ends his epic reign that's been going on since last June. All-time iconic moment. The crowd is just nuts. Great stepping stone moment for Warrior. He's slowly been built throughout 88, and this just kicks him into the next gear. He needed a thing like this to get him going. Like, he's I don't want to say he's been stalling, because he worked his way up, had the stuff with Hercules. Then he, of course, has the Weasel Suit series with Bobby, and that kind of gets him to the next level. And then this really is what he needed to get amped up in front of a huge audience. And I thought it was fitting for Honky to end like this. His run had gotten stale, diminishing returns week by week. We've chronicled it here, Scott. He was good through the end of 87. It's kind of fallen off since then. And I think ending it in an epic way is a nice payoff for what that angle was. He was a guy that cheated and wormed his way into this long reign, and he finally just gets fucking destroyed. Like, if this was like an 11-minute match and Honky just loses, it wouldn't have been as cathartic. You know, we needed him just to get mauled by a guy like this. So I went 3 stars because you got to fit somewhere in there. A lot of it has to just do with the moment and the meaning behind it. Put SummerSlam on the map as such a great moment. So, Scott, let's talk about the match, and then we'll talk about the Beefcake part of it.
All right. Warrior was a perfect choice. He's more, I mean, I hate to say it, in the longer stretch of things, he's more over than Beefcake, my opinion. I maybe some disagree with that, but I think Beefcake is a great character and does not really need a belt. I know some people don't like that thinking either, but I think even here, mid-'88, I think Vince was looking at Warrior as a long-term option for the next time Hogan needs time off. Because I'm sure even in 1988, No Holds Barred was not going to be Hogan's only movie. So looking ahead, I think Hogan was a guy that they – or Hogan, I'm sorry, Warrior was a guy that they were looking at as a long-term option. As for Honky, this needed to happen. Mm-hmm. He just needed to get just pummeled quickly and easily. The feud with Savage was great throughout 87. We had some good match. We had some great matches here at the Garden in 1987. But once he transferred off of Savage, I feel like he was kind of forgotten because Savage was obviously put into something else, and the world title situation kind of took center stage for those few months from, you know, January to April. So I feel like Honky was kind of floating aimlessly. And the Beefcake feud kind of tried to have legs and didn't. And then we saw what happened with Ron Bass. So I think in the grand scheme of things, I think Warrior was a better choice. And because I think Beefcake's one of those beloved guys, kind of like Duggan, where you don't really need them to win anything. They're just there to have good feuds and big moments in terms of interview segments and promos and sketches. But I really think that Warrior was a guy that Vince looked at as a future star, big time. And I also think, to back that up, that's why he had the Bobby feud and the Weasel suit, and we saw it at WrestleFest, to see if he could have the charisma to just not be kind of a vapid, faceless guy who's got face paint and goes crazy. And he showed a little bit of charisma in the feud with Bobby. And I think in the long run, this was the best option, Johnny, to pick Warrior in this spot.
Yeah, you nailed it, Scott. With Beefcake, it became all about the barber and cutting hair. Like even in the WrestleMania match, we saw that all Brutus cared about was cutting hair. And after every move, he would make the little scissors motion. He never made like the belt motion. He never cared, and he celebrated after the countout win, and it was like he didn't care about the belt. But this was I think this was a last minute decision, because the angle for the Bass was like on the go home superstar, so it was really rather late. I think this came up at the last minute where Vince and the boys, they just saw how the Warrior was getting over, and of course Warrior's body, that's going to win over Vince. So this was a last minute decision, and even on the video cassette, which is still in the Jade closet, I noticed they had the Beefcake versus a Honky Tonk Man, and then they like taped over it at the last minute, so even before the tapes were even distributed, they had Beefcake in there. So.
Yeah.
And for the match itself, it was a good thing it was short, because the three moves, I was watching, like Warrior, like practically whiffs on the clothesline, he barely hits them. And then when he's jumping over him, he almost tripped on Honky. So he almost
put that all on Honky. I think Honky is. I think he's awkward.
Yeah, Honky is all doofy and shit. Yeah.
But
like I said, it's more about the moment, not so much I mean, that moment, we'll be talking about it, and we're still talking about 30 years, and another 30 years will still be remembered. So it's not about match quality. Yeah.
In an interview in 2005, Beefcake claims that Warrior was threatening to leave if he didn't get a title shot. And Beefcake stepped aside. I don't believe that one bit.
That sounds like total Beefcake bullshit.
He didn't have any juice. He didn't have that much juice, not yet. He wasn't a diva that yet.
Right. So do you think
it definitely was a last-minute decision.
So you think it was last-minute. You don't think that was the plan all along?
Nah. I think they had Brutus, and then they just fell in love with the Warrior up until a month. And like Scott said, they realized that the other guys that were in contention, like Beefcake and Hacksaw, they don't need the belts because they have these gimmicks that the crowd goes crazy for. But Brutus with the haircut and right. Hacksaw with the hoe and the 2x4, so they don't need the belt. That Warrior, and for him, they saw money in him. And this, and if they strap the belt on him, that's just going to shoot him up there. Beefcake is rocket was kind of limited.
I think part of it too is Beefcake. I wonder if he didn't get over as much as they thought. Like, I know he's over, but maybe he wasn't as over as they thought. And they just thinking, okay, you know what? They held off at Mania thinking they would give it to him at SummerSlam or later in the year. And then as the year went on, they were like, okay, well, this isn't really lighting anything on fire. I don't know if they were running, if they were headlining B shows, like if they were still doing those at this point, him and Hockey. Like, I don't know if they weren't drawing. So I'm just curious if something like that changed as well. Whereas Beefcake suddenly kind of fell out of favor in a way. And Warrior was just getting so over that they couldn't, you know, they just had to do it.
I believe that. I think that, again, maybe the decision, John, was last minute within a, if it depends on how you're defining last minute. You mean like in the last week, in that last month? Because ever since Hogan came back, I think Vince, from this point forward, always realized that he needed to find another guy. Because, again, as I said, I don't think No Holds Barred was going to be Hogan's last movie. So I think in the back of Vince's mind, he always needed to find the next guy. Well, no, Savage was one, but maybe a couple years down the road. And I think that he looked at Warrior and said, Savage, you know what it is, too? Remember, this is a very kid – we're still very kid-friendly, and, you know, kids were the dominant – I mean, us, John, 15-year-olds, or JR, you know, JR getting there 6, 7, you know, between the ages of, like, 8 and 12, 13, that you needed very – kid-friendly, cartoony type of characters. And Savage, almost even as a babyface, Savage was just too edgy, very adult, mysterious. Warrior with the colored tassels and the face paint and the big bright boots and the bright tights and kind of like the crazy goofy kitty promos that made no fucking sense. I think kids were going to be attracted to him, like they're attracted to Hogan and the vitamins and the training and the prayers and all that. And I think – and I think when you're coming up with a champion, Beefcake, like I agree with John. I have nothing against Beefcake. But Beefcake had a ceiling. And world champion was not that ceiling. Same thing with Duggan. Duggan can't be cutting snot-filled promos while holding the world title. No. Those guys had a ceiling. Warrior just had that look that his ceiling was infinite. Mm-hmm. So I think, to a certain extent, looking ahead long-term, Warrior, I think, is a guy that he could, down the line, strap the rocket ship to, besides Savage. So that's why I think when he called an audible and was picking the next guy to crush Honky in front of this huge audience, Warrior was the guy.
And also, so, if Brutus, it would have just been a short reign because historically at this time, the IC belt was kind of more for the heels, mm-hmm. and the world champions stayed up with the faces. So even if they stuck with Brutus, it probably would only have been a couple of short reign.
Maybe, but if you look at it, they might have known, that the heel, the world belt was going to be on a heel soon enough. So maybe they figured.
Yeah. Sure.
It was time for a face, I see. But all right, so that was a good discussion. I think we've pretty much, come to our conclusions there. So why don't we do this? Why don't we take a break? We've dove into the first half of the show. We'll come back. We'll talk some pop culture, and we'll finish up SummerSlam. And then before you know it, we'll be on the precipice of episode 500. Be right back after this, brother.
Because brother Rose is
clear above the dean. Proud.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Hey, pro wrestling announcer Kevin Kelly here. I want to make sure you are all subscribed to all the great feeds here at Place to Be Nation. It's really easy to do. Just head to iTunes or your preferred podcatcher app today and search and subscribe to the Place to Be Nation Wrestling feed, which, of course, includes the full archives of the Kevin Kelly Show, the Place to Be Nation pod feed, and the Pro Wrestling Only feed. Subscribe, listen, and then rate us and leave feedback today. And be sure to give Justin your true thoughts. I mean, don't hold back. After all, he is kind of a jerk. Just listen to Scott.
Place for Nations, JT Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have a ton of great podcasts available to you on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceforNation.com. We offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place for Nation Wrestling feed, we bring you the Mothership, the Place to Be podcast, along with Main Event, Survey Says, the Monday Night Wars, and our monthly pay-per-view reaction show, as well as Jeff Learns Wrestling. In addition to these full-length shows, we also deliver special network podcasts and pod blasts on topics old and new.
Over on the Pro Wrestling Only feed, we dive deep inside the wrestling business with a stacked army of experts leading the way. The feed features potpourri shows such as This Week in Wrestling, Greetings from Allentown, Match of the Week podcasts, and the Military Industrial Suplex. We also have shows that focus intently on certain topics like Through the Years, Worldcast, Strong Style History, Strong Style Story, and Mount Olympus. Plus, the feed has the full archives of legendary shows like Titans of Wrestling, Where the Big Boys Play, Letters from Center Stage, and Letters from Kayfabe, plus much more. And on our very popular Place to Be Nation Pop podcast feed, we offer such great shows as Talking Pop, the Glenn Butler Podcast Hour Spectacular, NBA Team, PTB and Play, Sunday Groove, Breaking Balls, and Lucha Undead,
as well as a veritable podcast heaven for comics fans
with the Hard Traveling Fanboys, Sellers Points, Todd Weber's Conversations, Geek and Sassy, and Marvel Age Podcasts.
You can find all of these current shows, plus archives of our past podcasts, including the Kevin Kelly Show, as well by subscribing to both feeds on iTunes. And while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback today. All these shows, plus others, available at PlaceForNation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects, and more. Be sure to support our site by using PlaceForNation.com/Amazon when doing your online shopping, and download our free PTB Vintage Vault Refresh ebooks via the links on our site. We also want to thank our friends at Boneheads Wing Bar in West Warwick, Rhode Island, and Fall River, Massachusetts, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlaceForNation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
This is J.J. Dillon, the leader of the Four Horsemen, and you're listening to Place to Be Podcast.
All right, Nation, we're back taking a look at SummerSlam 1988 here on episode 499 of the Place to Be podcast. And, of course, episode 500, guys, just a couple weeks away. We've mentioned before it is the giant Place to Be Nation member, whether you're staff, whether you're a fan, however it is, you can join the trivia contest. However, that time is now come and gone. So if you have not signed up yet, the window is closed. We have, I think, 26 or 27 competitors. We'll be dueling it out on episode 500 to see who is the king of wrestling trivia on episode 500. So it'll be a lot of fun. Again, the window's closed for throwing your name in the hat. So hopefully you'll just all check out and listen and play along. I will say this. If you did reach out and you wanted to take part and you have not heard from me, message me somewhere on social media, Twitter, Facebook, whatever. I think there might have been one or two where I could not track you down that I had your name on a list. So if you have not heard from me as of like a week ago, I sent out kind of a generic here's what you need message and be ready. Just let me know if you're listening to this and you didn't hear from me. So with that said, it is now time to talk some pop culture with Scott Criscolo. And as I mentioned earlier, John D'Amato's on the show. And John, Scott talked about our basketball game we played earlier. It's been nice not having you out there. Those fucking orangutan arms blocking everything.
I was going to find something.
What does that got to do with pop culture, man?
You're a giant fucking monkey out there on the court with those big arms flailing around. And, of course, that is the number one song in the nation tonight.
Monkey.
That is Monkey. And speaking of monkeys, there's another one. Scott Criscola with this week's Pop Culture Corner.
Well, as long as you don't call me a spider monkey.
I'll leave that for Paul Orndorff.
Who wants to be Willie B at the zoo? Oh, my God. Well, thank you, JR, I think. Anyway, it is. You can hear him in the background. George Michael, who has had a great 1988 with his awesome album, Faith. And that is the number one song in the country this week. And, of course, as anticipated, Billboard is not loading as I'm trying to get the top 10 here. So we are going to hold off on the top 10 for the moment, let the page load, and we'll skip and go to – just JR, it was a busy Friday in the movies on that Friday. So why don't we do the movies first, let this fucking page load, and then we will get the top 10. So we'll begin with one of these typical – you know, sensual late 80s, you know, sexual erotic dramas that John D'Amato watched back in the day. It is called Betrayed.
Ooh. 1988 film. Not the Little Xan song, right?
No, not the Little Xan song. No.
Okay. Set in the American Midwest, the film begins with the murder of a Jewish radio host in Chicago. FBI undercover agent Catherine Weaver, alias Katie Phillips, sets out to infiltrate a farming community suspected of harboring those responsible. Starring Deborah Winger, Tom Berenger, John Hurd, Betsy Blair, John Mahoney, Ted Levine, Jeffrey DeMunn, Timothy Hutton as the juggler at the fair in a cameo. Albert Hall.
The juggler at the fair. So there you go. Tom Berenger, who, of course, I think the following year, maybe the year after, is when he would, of course, be in the awesome Major League.
Mm-hmm.
So there you go.
Major League was 89, yes.
All right. So the following year. All right. Second movie. This is one of these. This might be a good one because it's kind of a nondescript. Oh, no, I know what this one is. Ha ha. One of our favorite action film stars of the time who would be a future WWF pay-per-view guest. The movie is called Hero and the Terror.
All right. Danny O'Brien is a cop who likes to work alone and never waits for his backup. In L.A., O'Brien is trying to apprehend the notorious Simon Moon, also known as the Terror. Simon has been killing women by snapping their necks and taking them to his lair in an abandoned movie theater. O'Brien is attacked by Simon and almost kills him in the struggle. When the killer flees the scene and climbs up a ladder, he slips and falls, knocking himself unconscious. When the backup arrives, they think O'Brien caught the Terror, and the people of L.A. call him a hero. Simon is then arrested and taken to jail. Starring Chuck Norris, Bryn Thayer, Steve James, Jack O'Halloran, Jeffrey Kramer, Billy Drago, no one else worth knowing, Heather Blodgett, Tony DiBenedetto.
So there you go. Chuck Norris, the man. There we go. Third movie is, I like the little wordplay here. And it's got one of your favorite actors in it, JR, from one of your favorite movie franchises. The movie is called Hot to Trot.
Bobcat.
That's right. It's your boy.
Oof, ah. This is a rough week.
Yes.
And end of the summer is where they dump all the shit movies.
Pretty much.
This describes a lot of our friends here. Simpleton bachelor Fred Cheney inherits a bucktooth horse named Don and one half of a stock brokerage firm from his dead mother. He discovers Don as a talking horse who can speak the language of several other animals that belong to his deceased father. His stepfather, Walter Sawyer, offers to buy out Cheney's share of the business for a paltry sum, but Cheney refuses. Instead, Cheney returns Don to his talking horse family in the countryside and claims his place as partner at the firm. Starring Bobcat Goldthwait as Fred Cheney, John Candy as Don the Horse, Dabney Coleman, Virginia Madsen, Cindy Pickett, Tim Kazarinski, not a bad little cast here for this one, Burgess Meredith as Don's dad.
Simpleton bachelors.
We're fucking littered with them.
Oh my. We can go that far.
There's one for every. There's one for every episode here at PlayStation.com. 499 Simpleton Bachelors.
499 of them. All right, and finally, another one of those. A coming-of-age romantic drama entitled "Stealing Home." Oh, what a rough week. This is awful.
Oh, boy. Okay. In the 1980s, Billy Wyatt is a 30-something washed-up baseball player who now works as a high school groundskeeper, spending his days tending to the field and drinking. One afternoon, he receives a phone call informing him that Cade Chandler, an old acquaintance, has died. The bulk of the film consists of extended flashbacks to the 1960s, explaining Billy and Katie's relationship. Katie was a slightly older neighborhood girl who befriended Billy's mother, Ginny, who became his babysitter. And on, starring Mark Harmon as Billy Wyatt, Jodie Foster as Katie Chandler, Harold Ramis, Jonathan Silverman as a young Alan Appleby, Blair Brown, Richard Jenkins, my homeboy, he's in there, Helen Hunt. Mm-hmm. Not bad.
Wow, Jodie Foster and Helen Hunt, they almost look alike. And then what, Mark Harmon's best friend, Harper and Rowan?
Yes. Piper and Roman, I believe.
Jeez, I hope it was nice weather that weekend, because if you went out in a rain to see one of those friggin' movies.
Oof, ah.
Yeah, exactly.
That's awful. All right, so we got it up here. So here is your top 10, as mentioned. George Michael's Monkey, your number one song for the week. Number two, two and three, both start with the same three words. Number two, I Don't Wanna Go On With You Like That by Elton John, which is one of his lesser pop hits. And then number three, I Don't Want to Live Without Your Love by Chicago, which is an exceptional song, actually. Number four is actually my favorite song from this album, and that's probably my favorite song from this band, and that is Sweet Child O' Mine by Guns N' Roses from the equally awesome Appetite for Destruction album. Number five, Simply Irresistible by Robert Palmer. Tremendous song there. Fast Car by Tracy Chapman at six. Roll With It by Steve Winwood at seven. Perfect World by Huey Lewis and the News at eight. Our Girl Whitney at number nine with Love Will Save the Day. And at number 10, Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine with 1, 2, 3, Girl. Come on, baby, say you love me. Ugh. So there's your top 10. Monkey is your number one song for the week. We will skip baseball tonight. It's the end of August. Mm-hmm. The pennant races are still, kind of going on. The Mets are leading their division. There's a race in the East with the Tigers and Red Sox. Man, how old do you think Mark Langston is? He beat the Yankees on this night for Seattle, 10-10 for the Mariners. Unbelievable. Meanwhile, David Cone at 14-3, Mr. D'Amato shut out the Padres. This is a few years before he got caught, doing the puppet in the bullpen. But in any event, so there you go. And of course, JR, get yourself ready because you know what happens on our next vault. Not
I'm
our
ready
next
for
episode,
it.
But our vault. We are taking the field as when Mr. Nelson joins us for the September house show. The 1988 NFL season will be a few weeks old. So you've now beaten him. I think you've beaten him each year, correct?
Of course. 86, he sucks. 87. He's a worthless Canadian.
It is. And he's a Canadian and an Eagles fan. That's a terrible combination.
Yes, I already talked to him today about throwing down the challenge. So hopefully he'll be here for that one. So we'll be able to kick it off. Yeah.
So anyway, the 88. So the preseason's wrapping up, and your 1988 NFL season.
Mm-hmm. You should even it up and have a Canadian football prognostication. The Alouettes versus the Eskimos.
The Jaywomets.
The Jaywomets.
Versus the Eskimos.
Maybe he has all the games on DVD.
They pay their players in DVDs.
The Aragonauts.
The Aragonauts.
Snickers okay. For all bonus. Right.
Maybe we could do three play bets on the CFL there, John. All right. All right. And there's
the Hamilton Tiger Fet Cats.
And the two Rough Riders. Oh yeah. And that is your pop culture corner. Speaking of rough riding, let's get back to the garden.
Speaking of music, by the way, be sure to vote in the Greatest Song of the 80s tournament. We are into the round of 128.
Yes.
Each and every day at 10 o'clock. We have had some issues with the voting. We'll be covering that in the future. We'll leave it at that for now. But yes. We're into the official round of 128, round three. Be sure to get your votes in every day. These are all one-on-one matchups now. So the song's really cream of the crop.
Cream of the crop.
Some great
men without hats, bitches.
Yeah, right.
Safety dance, baby.
Simpleton bachelors. All right, Bobby Heenan joins the booth to give an update on what Ted DiBiase, Andre the Giant, Hulk Hogan, Randy Savage are all up to. He says, Andre's reading the Wall Street Journal. DiBiase's counting his money, and Virgil's just standing there enjoying it all. And Bobby says, Hulk Hogan and Randy Savage have barricaded their locker room door and are screaming and begging not to have to go through with this match tonight. Gorilla tells them to hit it. And they kind of tease Bobby almost falling, and it was pretty. That's a pretty good bit to kill a minute. So that brings us to our next match, and that is the Rock brother, Don Muraco, taking on Dino Bravo in a big WrestleMania 4 rematch. The juiced up Muraco hits the ring to a nice reaction. He points up to Billy in the booth. Heenan hangs out for this one, teases that Graham that he can't be at ringside. Bravo and Frenchie wobble out to the ring, looking as bloated as ever, each in their own way. Graham shits all over the weightlifting record, says it was bogus, brother. Calls for a legit bench press contest against Muraco. We start with a lockup and some feeling out. Muraco gets in a flurry until Dino bails to regroup. Gorilla calls Frenchie a piece of garbage as Bravo returns and drives Donnie to the corner. Graham says Frenchie hates the U.S. but loves the dollars, brother. Muraco comes back, gets a monkey flip and arm drag into an arm bar. Bravo comes back with some power offense, buries an elbow drop for two. Graham is still going on about the fucking bench press record as Muraco comes back with a Russian leg sweep. Muraco gets a backdrop and slugs Frenchie, and then we get a fake ref bump that allows Bravo to get out of a slam, and Bravo hits a side suplex for the win. Graham bitches about the ref, and that's not the first time this has happened to Muraco, so that's still going on. He's had these issues with the refs a few times that we've seen costing him matches. Nothing match. Muraco really had a slowdown for Bravo, and Dino's just fucking useless. I went a half a star on this one, John, and you know, Muraco and Patera are two guys that I thought deserve better on a show like this because they're in the same boat to me. Their face runs have been much better than I remember them being. I've enjoyed Don as a pumped up, energetic face. But, I mean, Bravo is just such a fucking slug that nothing is happening here. So it stinks that those two guys have worked hard and been pretty over his faces, but they've been stuck in these matches here on the big show with just guys that they can't do anything with.
Yeah, poor Muraco. But then again, he added to it because these guys look cooked. Like 2 minutes in, they were.
Oh yeah,
they were both sucking wind. One time, Muraco went to like whip them, and they both kind of clumsily just kind of collided into each other on a simple whip into the ropes. And also, your hatred of Frenchie is well deserved. He is horrible with the USA is not okay sign and he gives whatever his French promo before the match. Sacre bleu, Dr. G chili number one, Dr. G chili better than Criscolo.
This stupid fucking crap. Monocle. He's gonna shove it back into his eye.
It's a horrible night for managers. Horrible night.
And that jacket, what's it made out of? It's the weirdest fucking material.
the smock. It's a smock.
Yeah. Orion smock.
Smock him up. Yeah. Oh my god.
At least Gorilla gave Muraco some last props because after the win he said, "Oh, it's kind of an upset."
Yeah, true. Yeah.
Simply.
That's funny. We got the we got to fix the year. I don't know where we got this runtime. According to our vault refresh, the match was a minute 16. I don't think it was that short.
I don't know if we pulled that from wherever I had it from as like the tape. Maybe. I remember this match being clipped on the tape. Do you remember that, John?
Yeah.
Do you have the Coliseum version?
Yeah, definitely short, like about 2-3 minutes worth.
Yeah, because it's 5.5 per gram.
Yeah.
So,
I just looked at the grams too. I gave this 4.5. I think Muraco was. No, I'm only kidding. I actually gave this 2 stars.
Lord.
Because I think Muraco has really been. Kind of boned on some of this ref on these ref instances, and he's really worked his ass off. He really has. And Bravo's just a useless fuck. He really is. The guy has no. I mean, I'm watching these. I've been watching these All Stars from 78, 79 on the network where he, when he was in early, and he was actually halfway decent. In the WWF in 78, 79. And now he's just a bloated fuck. I mean, a guy can't even bend over. He barely could do the side slam finisher. It's fucking horrendous. And it makes it even worse for that fucking stiff Frenchie. Just the whole thing was a shit show. As for Muraco, another guy who, again, the roster's just getting too big, and there's just better talent coming down the pike. And this is the last time we see him. He's gone after this.
He should have brought the Meatball Hero for one more time.
He'll pop up in other promotions over the next few years, but we don't see him on a WWF camera for another.
Oh, really? He's not on MSG at all?
Oh, you know what? Maybe not. Maybe I'm thinking pay-per-view.
I thought he's at Survivor Series.
I don't. According to our vault, according to our refresh, he is not.
You're right. I think he gets replaced.
Let me check. We're chatting. I will look up if he's at any of the house shows coming up. I didn't think he was, but I might be wrong. Let me see.
No, you're right. I don't think he is. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think he is either. I think this is it for him.
All right, yeah. Well, no, it's sad then to see him go. I've enjoyed him.
Yeah.
Especially during this run. You know, I like some of his heel stuff too. I think he got a little sloppy, but I've enjoyed him as a face for sure here in 88. And I think, like many others on the show, obviously this is his final solo match, and for some, you know, his final other like I should say rather, so it's like so many others in late 88 just getting filtered out. So he finishes with a 1-5-1 pay-per-view record. His only win was at WrestleMania 4 in the opening round of the title tournament. His draw was WrestleMania 2, and then losses in every other match. We don't see him again on TV once he leaves until the Hall of Fame induction in 2004. So he leaves in October, and then he's gone until 2004 as far as being on TV. So long disappearance from him. And, yeah, obviously a guy who brought a lot to the table. He's been with us here on the show for a while. I don't know, what's kind of your favorite moment, John, as far as Muraco goes?
On this face front or as a heel?
Either way, one of each. I don't know, whatever you want to say.
Oh, well the heel, you got to go back to the snooker feud. Was when more like when snooker dove on him and from All-Star Wrestling. That's going way back. But I mean, this face run, he never really got like a shining moment. It was. He worked hard in all these matches.
Yeah, I've enjoyed him. They did a fine job, too, transitioning like the Billy Graham heat over to him with all the shit with like the gang and Butch Reed and all that stuff. So, you know, they've done nice work there. The hottest moment he might have had, Scott, that we've seen is that tag match with him and Warrior in the main event. Was that February or whatever? Mm. At MSG? Like, that was a pretty good moment for him, so that was kind of cool.
Mm. I agree with Johnny. Anything between 81 and 84 for Muraco is great. His promos were good. Him and Captain Lou, as much as I fucking hate him, at the time, at least as a heel, he was a good heat magnet. Are you talking about that episode, John? Was it like June or July when he like throws him into the fucking chairs and rips all his suit off and everything, right?
Yeah.
Was that All-Star?
Yeah,
that's fucking awesome. I will always say that he was the first wrestler that I ever watched on TV ever. The first time I ever put wrestling on in June of 1983, I put on an episode. It must have been Championship Wrestling or something, and I put it on, and the first guy I ever saw on camera was Magnificent Muraco as Intercontinental Champion. So, and I'll never forget that. And so Muraco always have a soft spot for me because he was the first. He would literally was the first wrestler I ever looked at. So, and that feud is the first feud I ever followed. So that's why both Muraco and Snuka. Well, maybe Snuka to a lesser degree now after what he probably did during those couple of years. But Muraco, I think he just got lazy in 86, 87. I think the babyface run was good for him. Another thing, JR, that we got to give credit for, that feud, remember that three match run he had with Hogan in 85? That was pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
That he had at the Garden.
Yeah,
those three,
very good.
Those three matches culminated with the cage. That was a fun little stretch he had. I think Muraco, regardless of what Parv says, I think Muraco gets a lot of undue shit. He did get a little lazy at times when he was a heel later on. I don't disagree on that. But I think he was a good heat magnet in his prime. And again, I think you got to watch. You got to watch as much 81 through 84 Muraco as you can. Muraco was a fucking beast in the pre pay per view era. No question mm-hmm. about it. So
on this last run at the initial turn was kind of when he broke off with Orton the tag team. So
yep.
That kind of spurred his bit. But unfortunately, Orton jetted after that, so he didn't really have that. That would have given those would have been some decent matches with Ace.
Mm.
And that could have gave him a little spark for this this babyface turn.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that either. Sure. Bummer.
All right. Well, we'll miss you, Donnie. I've done some yeoman's work here at 88. But
yes.
Time to say goodbye. And there'll be many more to come in the next couple of months, so as the purge continues. All right, Sean Mooney is with Jesse the Body. He says he's the only man that could handle this job, and he explains away DiBiase giving him money and saying he's not stupid. Of course, he would just take money if it's shoved in his pocket. That brings us to our big tag team title championship match, and that is the Hart Foundation challenging Demolition. A big match here as the Harts earn the title shot after a summer of not teaming much, which I thought was pretty interesting. So here they are. They elevate up pretty quickly. Ex-Harts manager Jimmy Hart is with Demolition and Mr. Fuji as he's plotting against his own old charges. And we find out as well that he still has the contracts of the Hart Foundation because the Hart Foundation fired him, but they're still under contract, so he still has the right to be at ringside. He's just out there plotting against them. So I think a pretty cool little storyline tagged on to this, a little advanced, honestly. Of course, he's out there with Demolition, Mr. Fuji. Demos have still been dominating and intimidating as always. Graham calls Fuji the man from Japan. Axe starts off clobbering Hart with ease, but Brett comes firing back. It's two on a roll-up, smash, and anvil tag in. The challengers keep control with brute offense from Neidhart. The tide turns, and the champs start to quick tag and pound away as Gorilla says Jimmy still has the contracts of the Foundation, like we mentioned. Axe drops his head and pays for it as Brett gets the tag and gets to work. Axe fights him off and starts to pound the arm to slow down the hitman. The champs tag on and off, twisting and stomping the arms. Gorilla criticizes Fuji for having his men work toward a submission instead of the usual style. Graham and Gorilla all over Anvil for not helping the hitman as the champs take liberties in and out of the ring. Brett gets a desperation clothesline, makes the tag, but the ref misses it, and the beat rolls on. Smash eats a boot on a charge, and Hart makes a tag this time. Anvil mows through Axe and Smash with power offense to a pop. Smash ends up outside, and Brett slingshots Anvil over the top and into him with a shoulder tackle in a wild spot. I thought that was really cool. Back inside, Anvil power slam Smash for a great two count. Brett follows with another good near fall and keeps bringing the heat with Axe making saves. Things break down as Fuji gets on the apron and gets whacked. And the ref gets mixed up with them. Jimmy gives Axe the megaphone. He blasts Brett with it, allowing Smash to cover for the win. A real hot match that cut a great pace, flowed with ease, had a smart storyline with Jimmy that built nicely to the finish as well. A real fun tag work by both teams. One of the best Demolition matches to date, I thought. And the rain continues on. The Harts have to regroup and deal with their old boss, who's really become a thorn in the side now, fucking them here. So I like the storyline. I thought it was really insightful. I thought it was shrewd the way they did it. And I like the match. I went 3 stars, and to me it's been the match of the night so far, Scott.
I concur. 3 stars as well. Let me talk about the Hart Foundation first. Mm-hmm. Are they in a funk? I feel like they spend the next – well, we'll talk about it obviously going forward, but I feel like they're almost kind of in the middle of the mix right now, and there's other teams – ahead of them, and they feel kind of muddled here. The match itself is fine. I think the match itself is exceptional. Demolition looks really good, but something about the Harts, I'm curious your thoughts, John. I feel like the Harts also look a little kind of, I mean, not as bad as the Bulldogs. The Hart Foundation are still the Hart Foundation, but they're definitely not feeling as crisp as they were even in 87 as champions, or early 88 chasing Strikeforce. I wonder if Demolition being champions has kind of hurt the face side of the tag division at the moment. I mean, no knock on Demolition as a team, but they're so dominant as heels, and they're actually getting some pops, which I talked about a minute ago. Earlier in the show, I was talking about the crowd kind of trying to decide what Demolition should be for them, and a proposed feud or future feud with the Powers of Pain. Is the crowd kind of creating who they want to root for? So there's a lot of dynamics in this match, but the first thing for me is the Hart Foundation, and do they feel stale right now? Do they feel like they're lost in the tag mix? I'm trying to figure that out, and as we keep watching, and not just the pay-per-views, but as we keep watching the MSG shows and stuff, I'm curious if I still feel that way in 6 months going into 89. Mm-hmm. As for Demolition, they look awesome. And I wonder if there was a clock ticking on them staying heels if there was a babyface turn planned at some point, and if so, when. So I'm curious, because there was some decent face pops in this match, too. The New York fans love Demolition now, even with the cheating at the end. I mean, remember, the Hart Foundation have only been babyfaces for a very brief time, so it's not like the whole world is behind the Hart Foundation at the moment yet, you know what I mean? So I don't even think they cared about the shenanigans at the end, because the Hart Foundation hasn't totally been enveloped as a babyface team yet. Maybe that's why I feel like they're stagnant, because they're kind of in between. But your thoughts, John, on the match. And what do you think about, A, where Demolition is right now in terms of, you know, fandom, and B, are the Hart Foundation lost in the shuffle right now?
I heard it a little differently than you. To me, the MSG crowd was hot. Maybe it's just hot for a title change, but they were way behind the Harts. There were some huge pops for the mm-hmm. for the Hart Foundation. And but as far as the Harts would be stale, that's because the commentary coming from Gorilla and Superstar from the Powers of Pain match, all they were talking about was the Powers of Pain and Demolition, Powers of Pain and Demolition. So they were downplayed as far as commentary, as far as their title shots, which kind of foreshadowed the ending of this match, that the Harts weren't going to get it. But, mm-hmm. but the crowd was solidly behind them. I don't know if it was for them, or maybe they were just dying to see a title change. But this crowd was great all night, so they souped everything up. Okay. But also, I like how Gorilla gave one of his classic Anvil lines, which he repeated many times. He said Anvil had to leave the NFL because it wasn't rough enough for him.
Right.
Yeah.
He's been saying that for 3 years.
I love that. That slingshot to the floor was great.
That was the move of the night, and the crowd went ballistic. But also, how about that replay at the end where they showed like Jimmy sneaking out from the back and flipping the megaphone? That's just textbook. I think that was Jimmy's showing his pride, saying, "Hey, you're fucking hiring all these freaking shitbox managers. This is how you do it." And the way he fucking snuck out there, and he gave like a perfect jump pass with the megaphone to Axe, and a pass that I've never seen on the court from Roger or Justin.
When we're through your orangutan arms. All right. So, I don't know if they've got lost in the shuffle per se. It is weird that they spent most of the summer apart and then they get the title match here. But I think they have the cred and the value to always be in the picture. So, and I don't know what else you would have done. I mean, the only thing they could have done, I guess, is if you did Hart's Rougeau's maybe and played off the Jimmy Hart stuff and done Demolition Bulldogs, which you've done at MSG over the summer a couple times. But I think it's fine the way they went here, especially since Jimmy, I don't think he's with the Rougeaus yet, so we haven't gotten that far in that storyline. So I think this is the only way you really could have gone, and they have the instant cred to be put into this match, regardless of whether or not they've been teaming.
Absolutely, I agree with that, sure.
All right, Mean Gene's with Honky Tonk Man and a bunch of other heels, and the former champ is pissed, ranting and raving about how he's been treated. The belt belongs to him, and he'll get it back. That brings us to our next match. That's Coco Beware taking on the Big Boss Man. Boss Man's ride as up the ladder continues as he gets a bit tougher competition that he's been dealing with in Coco. Slick is with the Big Boss Man tonight. Coco dances up the pile driver with Frankie. Boss Man attacks from behind, slugs Coco to the floor as Graham bitches about his gear. Coco comes back with right hands and a dropkick that gets Boss Man tied up in the ropes. Coco leaps into him with a headbutt and then punches away until he frees up. Coco walks into a front face lock and Boss Man hammers and headbutts him. Graham is still ranting about how Boss Man conducts himself as a Boss Man, as Boss Man hits a big splash in the corner. Coco eats a clothesline as Graham calls him the little Coco Man. Boss Man picks up Coco during a cover and then works his back. He goes up top, but comes up half empty on a splash as Coco didn't fully get out of the way. Coco dodges a charge and peppers away as Graham says he's inspired by Sugar Ray Leonard being in the crowd. Coco hits a perfect missile dropkick for two. Bossman brushes that off and hits a patented side move, as Gorilla calls it, for the win. Bossman smacks him with a nightstick after, and we get a fun little squash. It got real hot at the end. I like the finish. With Coco with the dropkick and then on from there. He does a nice job. Bossman continues to look like a beast as they really just put him over strong here as he works his way through the card. I went 1.5 stars on this one, John.
Both of these guys, I think they had there must have been the low flow showers in the MSG locker room. That was, both of them were very puffed out. poofed out hairdos, which was very distracting to me.
I'm sure Jesse would have had a comment on Coco's hair if he was around tonight.
Oh, yeah. But Bossman gave him some competition, too. He was working on whatever, his little man fro. And another thing that was distracting was midway through the match, Bossman's bottom button took off. He must have been digging into that the KOC training contest of 1988. his boiler was exposed to another distraction.
No, he was noshing on the doctor right there.
But there was some hot little action before the ultimate squash there. Yeah. And Coco fired up I hate to keep repeating every match, but the crowd was great tonight. And even in a match like this where Coco obviously had no chance, but they still pop for Coco's offense, simply.
I give this a star. Simply just, character advancement. Boss Man's had a good summer of squashes on superstars. Mm-hmm. I remember him squashing a lot of guys
and
on superstars.
MSG and WrestleMania. Like, we've seen a bunch, too.
Yeah. Yeah, he's been everywhere. So he's definitely gotten the exposure to it's a guy, again, Vince, snagged from Crockett and wants to use him a lot on TV and show them that you guys were using him right. And I don't say they weren't, but, he was kind of, he went from being a jobber to Cornette's bodyguard, so he really didn't have much, he had a very low learning curve. But, served its purpose, and Coco did the right thing. Boss Man had the cuffs and everything. So not much more to say here.
No.
Just a good good old-fashioned character advancement match. So good win for Boss Man.
And we mentioned – Billy Graham mentions Sugar Ray Leonard to the crowd. That's all cut out of the network version. Did you watch your tape, John? Or did you watch the network?
Yeah. They were pumping the match with Donny Lalonde. Vince's one and only foray into boxing pay-per-view.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, they hyped that thing. They cut it all out of the network. It's not anywhere on there. But they hyped that thing to death. I mean, they mentioned it. They would show a few multiple promos for it on this night. So luckily we're spared that. The only really mention of Sugar Ray is Graham here, I think.
Yeah.
Yep, the match was actually on. Let's see, it was Sugar. I'm looking at Sugar Ray's match list here. The fight was on November 7th at Caesar's Palace. It was a TKO in the 9th round. Donny Lalonde was Canadian, by the way, which I didn't know, and he was the WBC light heavyweight champion, and the WBC had an inaugural super middleweight title, so Sugar Ray won both of those. He would fight four more times, Sugar Ray. He would draw Thomas Hearns. He beat Roberto Duran again. He would lose to Terry Norris. He fought Hector Camacho in 97. I don't remember that. Donny Lalonde was Canadian, which I didn't know. Yeah. His final record is...
Business-wise, it must not have been successful because they didn't try this ever again, I don't think.
Right.
Yeah.
As far as boxing. Yeah.
Yeah. He had a decent record. 41-5-1 with 33 knockouts. Not bad. So that's what happened in that fight and then didn't deal with it again.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Next up, Sean Mooney's with the Ultimate Warrior and a bunch of faces. They're all fired up about the win. Warrior rambles as he caps his ascendant moment. And that brings us to our penultimate match of the night, and that is Jake the Snake Roberts taking on Hercules. And this is our last match before the main event. Hercules still hanging around the midcard as a heel, but clearly fading. Bobby Heenan is not even out there with him. Gorilla One knows where he is. Jake arrives to a big pop for the second time we've seen him tonight. This is the first time he's wrestled in MSG since February. Jake peppers away to start. Gorilla and Graham continue to wonder why no brain. Graham also gushes over Herc's body as he clobbers a snake. Jake comes back with a knee lift and goes for the DDT, but Herc bails to the floor. Jake gets to work with a side headlock, cranking it on tightly. We get lots of talk and focus on Jake's issues with Rude as Herc turns it around, hits a headbutt to the gut. Herc gets roasted for a lazy cover and then goes to a chin lock. Gorilla thinks Bobby may have been trapped in an elevator or an escalator. Maybe laugh. Gorilla now says Herc is on top of his game and never looked better, saying his body is fine-tuned, even though he was just shitting on him for lazy pins a minute ago. Jake fights up, but Herc slugs him down out of the ring, and he keeps clubbing away as he comes back to the apron. Jake yanks down and drags Herc over the top to the floor to gain a breath. Herc comes back in with heavy shots and a chin lock. Jake quickly busts it with a jawbreaker and punches away. Herc counters a DDT with a backdrop and then dodges a knee lift. He stomps away and slams Jake and drops a hard elbow for two. Jake slips over Herc and hits a flash DDT for the win. This was a fun finish and a solid match. The chin lock was a little bit too long, but the rest was well worked. It told a nice story, and Herc showed some real good offense, dominating and showed that the DDT can... he was dominated, but he showed the DDT can end it in a blink, and that's what makes Jake so dangerous. And then he throws a snake on Herc after the match. So I thought it was a fine little win for Jake. I thought Herc looked, you know, solid as he has. He's on that list of guys that have been kind of impressive here, 87, 88. I do think Herc is losing steam as a heel, so I think that, you know, any turn that's coming is probably well-timed because he's kind of just got nowhere else to go at this point. He's really maxed out in this role. So I went 2.5 on this one, Scott.
JR, I went 2 stars. I thought the match was fine. I've liked Herc. You've kind of won me over with him in our viewing. But the headlock thing reminds me of a reason why, you know, I know for years and years before we did this vault refresh, we always talked about, oh, why didn't they do Jake and Rude here? I mean, for God's sakes, the feud's been going on for, what, 5 months and blah, 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 blah. I'll tell you why. Because they're not wrestling the match right. We watched it at WrestleFest, and it sucked. Because you're talking about a blood feud between two guys. The one guy's got his wife, got his rival's fucking wife's face painted on his fucking crotch. I beat the fucking shit out of him. And instead, we're getting headlocks and fucking submission grabs. And what the fuck is this? It should be a brawl. It should be a blood fight. And instead, we're getting like normal WWF wrestling. Like, I really got upset when we watched at WrestleFest that these guys were not thinking outside the box, the booking, to make this a blood feud. So, you know what? I'm glad we didn't get it tonight.
Right.
Fine. All right. So we had to watch JYD for 4 minutes. Whatever. It was quick and painless. And this match wasn't horrendous. But what the fuck? I mean, if we were going to get this match at tonight on this show and get a nice fucking big ugly brawl with punches and he rips the tights off and, you know, Rude gets mooned and thrown into the – I don't even care if Rude wins the match by countout or DQ because Jake's just beating the shit out of him. Fine. But don't give me the match again if we're going to get fucking 12 minutes of headlocks and fucking
right. –
Jesus Christ, that's not a blood feud match. That's like just going through the motions. And this feud is too good to go through the motions. So, fine. If you're not going to give me a match where Jake's just going to fucking go nuts, don't give it to me at all. I'm fine with the JYD mess earlier. It was only 4 minutes. And this was, again, this was fine. Herc's fine. Looks good in the ring. Character-wise, he's definitely due for something soon. But it's like... But I guess my whole point is I'm fine now that I think about it, my opinion has changed over the years, John. I'm not as all into, oh, we need a Jake. We needed a Jake, Rude match here. If we were going to get more grabbing and holding and fucking around like they did in Milwaukee, it would have been a total waste, in my opinion, particularly for this crowd. You know, a crowd in Milwaukee probably could care less, but if you're going to give the Garden crowd a blood feud match, don't do a bunch
well. They
of
wanted to keep it going.
Shit.
I mean, they wanted to keep the feud going on the house shows
too.
So we would have had if they did have it here, would have had to be a fuck finish, which they probably wanted to avoid another one. So
maybe. So I'm fine with it. I'm fine with it, John.
Yeah, the undercard gets shit on, but business wise, people are going to tune in because the main event is a one time only match and that's what's going to sell it. I don't think anybody said, oh, I'm not ordering a pay-per-view because they're not having Jake and Rude or whatever. So that's been discussed ad nauseum. So they did what they did. But here, as far as this match is concerned, they kind of showed that Brain was kind of giving up on Hercules because he didn't even bother showing up to the ring.
Right.
And Gorilla pointed it out. So, but this is a good showcase. At least it showed Jake was able to get the DDT on, and that pops the crowd no matter what. It makes the crowd happy that Jake got the DDT on Herc and the snake, and he gave Hercules a little extra with the snake in the face. So the crowd got this is a crowd pleasing card pretty much the whole way. with the IC title change, finally getting off Honky, and this, they got to see the DDT, so it accomplished what it needed to.
Can't go wrong with an electric snake in your face, so.
Woo!
All right, gentlemen, main event time, and that is the Mega Powers taking on the Mega Bucks, Randy Savage, Hulk Hogan, Ted DiBiase, and Andre the Giant. Huge main event. Hulk Hogan returns to action. We culminated over a year's worth of feuds. And, of course, he had returned to WrestleFest, but returns nominally here. The build has been tremendous, and everything lines up perfectly. Jesse Ventura in his ref adds a piece as well that piles up the odds against the Mega Powers, puts more star power as well. Great heat in the Mega Bucks. Just an epic group of heels right now, smirking and stalking to the ring. Mega Powers come out to Randy Savage's music. The crowd is all fired up, as is Billy Graham, just gushing over Hogan's physique. The Mega Powers have awesome matching gear on. That was really cool. We set up for really a big payoff here. So much star power loaded in the ring. These guys have been going at it for over a year. We get a lot of posturing and set up as Jesse... I shouldn't say over a year, so just about a year, under a year. We get a lot of posturing and set up as Jesse switches the tag ropes for some reason, which I still don't understand to this day, why he flips the tag ropes around. And then gets in Hogan's face when Hogan confronts him about it. Andre swats Savage around at the bell, then tags in DiBiase. We reset. Ted calls on Hogan and Macho obliges. Hogan comes in and hot and batters Ted around, leveling with a clothesline. Savage comes in, and we get some double-team offense and quick tags to show the continuity. Ted has taken a beating but survives some pin covers. Virgil and Bobby start to get involved, but DiBiase takes over as Liz gets on the apron and gets screamed at by Jesse. Andre arrives and leans on Hulk with his weight while also battering him with strikes. Andre chokes away and tags Ted, who lands some more shots and goes to a chin lock. Gorilla and Graham bitch about it and call it a choke, but Jesse just ignores it. The crowd wills Hogan to bust the hold, and the two wipe each other out with clotheslines as Hogan makes the tag. Savage unloads on Ted with strikes and pelts him with a double axe off the top, whiffs on a charge, comes back with a crossbody for two. Ted cuts him down to clothesline, tags Andre, who smashes Macho in the corner. Billy and Gorilla continue to ride Jesse as he gives all kinds of leeway to the Bucks. Ted is back in and grabs two on a suplex, but Savage slithers free for the tag. Hogan hammers away and drills Ted with a clothesline and gets a suplex as the crowd is going nuts. Andre comes in but gets walloped by Hogan, and he falls to a big pop. Hulk then locks on a sleeper. Savage comes off the top, but he eats a huge boot from Andre in a really cool spot. Andre busts up the sleeper with a headbutt and throws Hogan to the floor. As the Mega Bucks regroup in the ring, the Mega Powers gather their bearings. And, of course, as that's going on, the iconic moment that we all know and love, Miss Elizabeth gets on the apron, talks to Jesse, and then strips off her skirt to show bikini bottoms. That shocks the world in an iconic moment. Everyone is frozen in amazement. That allows the Mega Powers to do their epic handshake at ringside. They come in and clean house, and a moment later, Hogan slams Ted. Savage hits the elbow. Hogan drops the leg. And then Jesse goes to count. Of course, he stops at two. Savage pushes his hand to the mat for three. Red hot finish, a perfectly paced and booked match. Nice and tight. He told a good story, didn't overstay its welcome. Put two feuds to bed all at once with Hogan and Andre, Savage, DiBiase. The feuds that have really, I mean, Hogan and Andre has been going on since January of 87, and Savage and DiBiase have been going on since March. So both of those are put to sleep, and it furthers the story of the Mega Powers. So there's so much going on and so many different through lines in this match. Strong finish to a big night of action. I went 3.5 on this. It holds up really well, and I just love the pacing, the fact that it's just, 13 minutes or so, so we're not overstaying the welcome. We're in and out. I thought it was really well done overall. So what did you think of this one, John?
This match is so special, especially because it's a one-time match. It's never be duplicated with these teams. And everything was done perfect. You had Jesse in there, which I love that. Like I said, for no reason, he just switches the ropes. He just has to show his authority and do something. And he couldn't wait. Or Hogan just taps him on the back, and right away he says, "Don't touch me." And he just had to do it to show his authority.
It's like Jesse's dream, though. He finally gets in there with Hogan in a big match, and he gets to fucking be a dick to him. this is what he's been waiting for.
That's exactly why he was just stalling and changing the ropes. He's just waiting to pounce on Hogan for doing that. But the thing was that during the match, friggin' Gorilla and Superstar were hopping on, "Oh, Jesse's got to get down there." But to me, Jesse didn't really do anything like heelish up until the end, where, the hesitating on the count. But Jesse didn't really do anything blatantly, obviously, to favor the heel. So Gorilla and Superstar were kind of souping it up, but I didn't really see anything. And I thought that way back then that maybe they were going to have a last run with Jesse, that maybe Ted would, they were going to have a feud with him and DiBiase, but Jesse couldn't go anymore.
No,
but that was just daydreaming at the time. Looking back, it was Jesse couldn't go anymore. But there was some talk about that amongst the wrestling 1988 Twitter. But just the iconic moment when Liz removed the skirt and friggin' Andre, Ted and Jesse, the three guys who probably had more tail than the whole fans in the garden put together, and they're all just sitting there stunned like they've never seen a woman before.
It's funny. That was one of the things.
Just priceless.
When I watched that with Jeff originally, on Jeff Learns Wrestling, that was one of the things he called out. I was like, why were they so shocked? Like, what did she do to make them? But you know, I think it's just that it's Elizabeth, and no one expects her to do that, right? So it's almost like, whoa.
Oh, of course, it's ridiculous. But and at the same time, it also made sense. It worked out perfectly. Just excellently booked, and once again, the crowd responded. Man. Terrific setup.
Yeah, your match time is 14:48. I mean, I gave this 3.5 stars. This is probably one of my favorite pay-per-view main events of all time. Crowd's amazing. You've got four expert studs in there in terms of storytelling and I'm Vince, I'm thrilled with this main event. I have no problem with it at all. I do think that Jesse's refereeing, and this is the problem. This is the problem. And I said this, we've said this in the past, JR, and it's still, I'm sorry, to me it still holds up today. I understand that the whole premise of Jesse as ref is, you know, he's a heel, get it. And in the superstars leading up, you know, DiBiase sticking, you know, money in his pocket and all that kind of thing. However, realistically, you're watching this match, Jesse's really not that bad. Other than the count at the end, which I guess you get.
Well, there's a few spots, like with the choking and that stuff and whatnot.
And I think there's other parts where I think he's just not – I just don't think he gets it, or he may just be caught in the middle of something. But it's not horrendous.
Right.
And Gorilla and fucking Superstar making it out like he's Danny Davis. Yeah. I mean, it was – I thought they were going overboard. And I think – and I also think Vince probably was in their ears like really hammering home, Jesse's bad, Jesse's bad. Meanwhile, Jesse really – unless Jesse didn't do it enough of it, I don't know. But I thought they went a little overboard. And we're not as bad. He was not as bad as either he A was supposed to be, or B, Gorilla and Superstar made him out to be. It was getting overkill after a while. I think I think Jesse was trying to restore order and he wasn't just getting the chance to. I mean, he's dealing with Andre, for Christ's sakes, not exactly a fucking Sam Houston. And I think that took away a little bit of the match for me. I think those guys were just so programmed to bash Jesse because he was the ref and a heel, that even though he really was not that bad, they were just beating the shit out of him. Now, having said that, the match is still fantastic, and Savage and Hogan are on top of the world right now. I think Savage has been a tremendous world champion while Hogan's been gone. I think he's done an outstanding job with the fans. I think he's connected with the fan base. We've said this ad nauseum. We don't have to keep getting into it.
Mm-hmm.
But Andre is just a fucking stud.
Yeah. 80 has been his year, for sure.
He's just a fucking stud, and it doesn't stop for him.
No.
We'll get more into it on the next Vault, 501, I guess. But this match, except for the commentating, which isn't the worst thing in the world, but I needed to make that point. The match is fantastic. And you're looking at two fantastic tag teams, four great workers. And I agree. I agree with the Elizabeth point of it wasn't more, oh my God, I've never seen a chick with hot legs and a tight ass before. It was more like, Elizabeth, what are you doing? You know, that kind of thing. I think that's what. So I agree, John. I think I don't think, like you said, plenty of trim going around in the DiBiase locker room. That's for sure. But again, we're not talking like, you know, fucking. I was gonna say Moolah, but God only knows, no one wants to see that. I don't know, like Sonny in or Precious in World Class. We're not talking heel valet kind of thing. You know, sweaty whore looking porn star.
When Sandy came out at the end of Grease.
Exactly. There you go. Sandy came out. Yeah. Yes.
Sandy. Yeah.
Sandy, tell me about it, Stud. Yeah. But that's actually a great. That's a great. As much as you're kidding a little bit, it is actually a pretty solid comparison. If you've seen Grease, so I think that actually worked. At first, you're like, oh my god, you know, all right. So there's a chick with a tight ass and nice long legs, but you're talking about somebody who, even though she dresses very well, is very elegant, but she's very proper. And here's Elizabeth, you know, and then of course, as JR says, we get the awesome yeah handshake, which is iconic in its own right.
And I'm surprised also, I never noticed before, but they didn't have separate entrances. Macho and Hulk came out together to Macho's music. That was that was
very cool.
Yep.
Yeah. And when was the last time that Hogan had something on his tights? He actually had mega powers on his big butt.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know, usually Hogan doesn't have anything on his tights. So they were definitely in symmetry, and I thought that was pretty cool. But anyway, fantastic match. One of my favorite pay-per-view main events. The announcing doesn't take too much away from it. But a great moment for all of them. I liked Elizabeth's kind of, you know, calling an audible there. And, yeah, great way to end the show.
Do you guys think it was planned at the end when Macho had Liz on his shoulders and Hulk really propped her out? Hulk really grabbed a nice cheek to prop her up there. And the camera got it perfect. Do you think that was, like, planned or that was just spontaneous? Because he didn't want it to fall. He really got a nice... nice feel there.
I never thought of that. That's funny. Well, if he did, no wonder Hogan's pissed. No wonder Savage is pissed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know. But anyway, great way to end the show. Great way to end the show.
Agreed. All right. So why don't we get to some awards, and then we can wrap up this puppy. So let's bring this up here. Match of the night, I think, is obviously all Mega Powers, Mega Bucks.
Main event, yes.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
The Cousin Junior for the worst match of the night. I went with Muraco Bravo.
Yeah. There's really not much worse.
All right, Hogan Award for the MVP. I went with the Warrior. Like, to me, the main event, obviously, they all could have been in it because it was so great. But it really, when you think of this night, even though you think of the Elizabeth stuff and the handshake and all that, I think the first thing that pops into most people's minds, it has to be the Warriors' big win over Honky. Like that's kind of the iconic takeaway from the show for me. And it was his night for Ascension, so.
Yep. No, I don't think there's any doubt.
I'm gonna go with Liz, believe it or not.
Okay.
I think that was just such a crazy moment that, as we discussed, the shock. I'm gonna go with Liz.
All right. All right, up next is our Uncle Elmer Award for the least valuable, worst worker. I went Dino Bravo here, and to me it's not even close. He's the worst.
Bravo, yeah.
Ugh, that match is such the shits. So bad. Bad way for Muraco to have to go out.
All right, for the best moment here, I went with Elizabeth, her stripping down and leading to the finish of that match.
Yeah, definitely.
I think it was Jake and Hercules chin lock. No, I'm only kidding. her ripping off the vet, her ripping off the skirt, and our awesome JR's and my awesome Place to Be podcast handshake.
Mm-hmm.
That whole bit, right? That whole like 3 minutes right there, that culminates in the yeah right under the apron. Yeah, the whole
all
thing
right.
For me.
The Muraco Award for the most juiced up. The two main competitors for the all of '88 faced off tonight, and that was Tom Muraco and Dino Bravo.
Yes.
You got to go Muraco though. It's his final swan song. The last time he'll win the award. He has won it. Well, give me yours, and I will count. You guys agree?
Oh, no, definitely. It's got
to
go.
I have to disagree. I'm going to give it to somebody I have a feeling who is going to take over the naming of the award in the future, the Ultimate Warrior.
All right.
Okay.
He's won. I can't believe you're going to take it from Muraco on his final night. Warrior did win it as a tie with Bravo back in April. All right, let's see how many times Muraco has won this award. Of course, we named it after him. He did not win it in 85. It was originally the RCD award, right? And
yes. He first won it in...
Actually, it was the Atlas award.
Yeah. He first won it...
March 86.
He'll get a Warrior Award soon.
Well, March I don't know. Muraco's got a lot. I don't think Warrior could pass him. So Muraco's got one.
Two. Are you counting halves or no?
Yeah, that counts because we gave it to him. D'Amato stonewalled him again at WrestleMania 3. So that's two. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 times. I don't think Warrior. I don't know if Warrior is on that much. We'll see.
Not even close.
16 time winner. I mean, so a couple of those are halves or thirds, but he's at least been a partial winner 16 times. So, all right, worst hair, you got to go Kenny Patera. Even the Bossman and Coco were in the mix.
Nah, I'm going Coco.
You going Coco?
Yeah.
Hey, Jeff, you weren't. For a fucking guy who at the beginning of the show said that I'm going to be very emotional tonight, and you fucking steal the awards away from the two guys whose awards are named after. You don't even give it to them.
That throw was puffy, man.
It's Patera, though. He's got the worst hair of all time.
Coco had some extra soul glow going on or something, man.
I got to give it. I mean, it's their farewell trophies. I mean, Patera – well, I'll defend Kenny's because Kenny is at Survivor Series, so he may get it one more time. But shame on you for not letting Muraco have his moment. Damn you. We're done. Anyway, I'll give it to Kenny because his hair is just abysmal. But
all right, final grade of the night out of 10. It was a good show, not a great show. There's a lot going on, a couple of historical moments. Nothing really too bad. I mean, we had a couple of blah matches, but nothing awful. But again, the highest was that 3.5 in the main event. I had the hearts at 3 and then nothing else over that. I went 6 out of 10 for this inaugural SummerSlam, which I think is a solid grade when you look at what the card was and what they provided. I definitely enjoyed it quite a bit on this watch, I think, more than in previous ones. I think, again, watching the build and how everything comes into play played a role in that as well. And honestly, after watching some of these MSGs and WrestleFest, it felt like such a breeze and an easy watch. Like, WrestleFest really made this seem a lot better. That was such a long, bloated slog to get through. And then this was like, wow. Like, it was, the quality was good. It made sense. And we kind of cruised through it. It was just under 3 hours. So, like, it definitely felt a lot. I think WrestleFest being so shitty made this also stand out as pretty good.
Mm. Yeah, I got the 6.5. And it was 10 matches. And the longest ones went to the guys that deserved it, like the Hearts and the Demols and the Rougeaus and the Bulldogs. So the workers got the longest matches. And the shitties, the shits got the shortest matches. So go with 6.5 due to the two iconic moments that we'll be talking about in the 60 years from now.
And what was yours, Scott?
I tell you, this it began a great tradition, a great company tradition. I love SummerSlam, always have and always will. And when I graded this today, and this is probably like, I don't know, the fucking 14th time I've seen this show, probably 15th time I've seen this show. I try to think to myself, all right, this is booked exactly like WrestleMania. Now, WrestleMania 1 was a glorified house show. And this is kind of a glorified house show.
No, not as bad, though. Yeah.
But not as bad. So this is definitely a better card, but I'm not going to do the 10 that I gave WrestleMania 1. That's different. That's the beginning of an era. But I'm actually going to bump it even slightly higher than John. I'm going to give it 7. I thought the iconic moments were iconic. The shit was not – did not take away from anything and was brief. It's a show that – it's and I think you're right, JR. I think it's – as much as I think it's an easy show to watch anyway, I think after watching that fucking meat grinder that was WrestleFest, I think this is just so much – it was so nicer to kind of breeze through. And it was a quick 2.5 hours. It's probably like – I mean, it's a good hour, obviously, shorter than our last pay-per-view was, yeah. WrestleMania 4. So
yeah, it was like 2:45. I mean, I know it's probably trimmed a touch without the LeVon bullshit and everything else. But still, it was an easy watch compared to
definitely.
WrestleFest.
Awesome crowd, too. Awesome crowd.
Yes, crowd was pumped. 7 for me.
All right, there you have it then. SummerSlam 88 in the books, as is episode 499. We'll be back in 2 weeks' time with episode 500, if you can believe it or not. It's taken us, 7.5 years, but here we are, episode 500. Yep. will be a giant trivia contest. Of course, there'll be other fun and frivolity mixed in there as well. Like I said earlier, if you did not hear from me to confirm and you were officially entered into the tournament, let me know and we'll get you involved. Make sure to subscribe to all of our feeds, PlayStation Wrestling, PlayStation Pop, as well. And, Scott, anything else you want to plug coming up?
Well, we just last week, we did an exceptional episode of Main Event, myself, Nate and Steve, we recapped All In and then did our, pay-per-view, our next installment of our TNA, pay-per-view recaps. Check out the Facebook page this week because we'll be putting up, two matches that one of which will be doing our New Japan Classic match pick segment next week. So keep an eye on the Facebook page and vote on which match. We haven't decided which two yet, but stay tuned in the next couple days and make your pick. And we'll do that match next week. So stay tuned.
John, you actually got shit to plug these days. What do you got going on?
Yes. Me and the Cowboy are going to get together and do a week one cast off of our successful NFL preview podcast with Nick Duke. And we're going to run it right back and have a week one reaction. And also every Wednesday, a column from yours truly, or I wouldn't actually call it a column, just random observations from a humble NFL fan. Every Wednesday, look for that. Wednesday AM QB from the JAD.
Oh, yes. Speaking of columns, thank you, John. Posting today and every Tuesday at around 4 o'clock, myself and Logan Crosland have our campus hot takes where we give you the weekend recap in college football, some of the big games, and looking ahead to the big games this coming weekend. So that's just posted today, so check that out. And every Tuesday afternoon will be the campus hot takes, myself and Logan Crosland talking college football.
All right, by the time you listen to this, it'll likely be Wednesday, so be sure to check out Stacey's Divas Deep Dive. This week, another great installment of that series, which drops every Wednesday afternoon. Like I said earlier, vote in the 80s tournament too, and just check out everything we've got each and every day at placementnation.com. I'm really proud of kind of the reboot of the written content that we've had going on. We have some fresh voices. We have the rebooted network adventure series. We have our live group watch champions doing a monthly installment. So there's lots of cool stuff popping up here and there all over the site. Like John mentioned, his Wednesday morning quarterback. More sports content is coming to the PlayStation Pop feed as well. I know Nick's planning on some NFL and college stuff. John, you mentioned doing the Cowboys. So lots going on. We're going strong still here in year number five.
Got another pay-per-view Sunday. Another pay-per-view reaction next week.
That's right. Possibly. We'll have that as well. Yeah, we're going to get that.
We'll recap it on Main Event as also next week. So.
Okay, and last week we did have a new No Holds Barred. We talked about, of course, the greatest tag team ever tournament. We talked about the 80s music tournament. And some other stuff is there. Check that out on the PlayStation Wrestling feed. And I believe there'll be a new Wrestling Warzone coming late this week as well. So, all right, that'll do it. 499 times, Scott, we've done this, amazingly enough.
Yes, we have, sir.
So we're going to sign off. And the next time we talk to you, our party pants will be on and then off as we celebrate the big 500th episode of this show. So, John, thanks for joining us. Like I said earlier, it was a great honor to have you here, one of the OGs the nation. It was very fitting to have you here tonight, and you did a great job, so thank you.
Thank you, guys. Congrats. Let's fire up the chili.
Let's do it. All right, we're out. We'll talk to you in 2 weeks, PlayStation Podcast, episode 5. Fucking